This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
And here we go.
This is what you can look forward to on episode 130 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
Take my love, take my land, take me where I cannot stand.
So after getting so much hate mail, I finally buckled down and watched Firefly. I can just see Mark Hamill going, off to Neverland! You guys are like a twister of cosplayers.
Yes, that's a good way to put it, actually.
No, it's too much air conditioning, alcohol, and lack of sleep.
I've never seen Yogi Bear do that.
Well, look at it this perspective, guys. You could have been eventually called Star Killer Through Neverland.
Star Killing Through Neverland.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Hello, Skywalkers.
Baby, listen. Off to Neverland.
Yeah! I only hope that we never lose sight of one thing, that it was all started by a mountain.
Wow.
You are skywalking through Neverland.
Hey, Skywalkers! Welcome back to
Skywalking Through Neverland.
We are the family-friendly Disney and Star Wars podcast that brings you entertaining stories from creators and fans. We want to give a big thank you to our Skywalker family out there who helps us out each and every week, whether you're just listening or posting on our Facebook group, or spreading the word about the positivity about our adventure through fandom. I am Richard, and now everyone please say hello to my sweetie wife, Sarah.
Hey, hey, I was expecting you to say something more about me, but I guess not this week.
But you're my sweetie wife.
Well, okay.
That speaks volumes.
It does, it does. So we want to thank you everyone for tuning in, whether it's your first time or whether it's your 130th time. We love it. And we thank you so much for supporting this show throughout all social media, whether you're watching us now on Periscope at Skywalking Pod, or if you tweet at us during the show, which we love, which is also at Skywalking Pod. We try to keep it easy over across all our social media.
Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on July 26th, 2016. But before we get into our big convention coverage episode, we have another foreign dub contest.
We do?
Yes, we do. This is where we play a scene from a Star Wars or Disney film, and you, the Skywalkers, have to guess what film it's from. All you gotta do is tweet at us the film, the scene, and if you know the language for bonus points.
Oh.
And you will be the foreign dub winner of the week.
How many bonus points do they get?
One.
Okay.
Now, here is the scene. So, if you know the film, the scene, and the language, tweet at us at Skywalking Pod.
Nice.
Good luck.
Yeah.
Now, one more thing we want to mention is that we are on another episode of VoxBox Star Wars Comic Book Podcast. Now, this is the show that does, in a nutshell, what we do with our classic Marvel Star Wars comics with Randy Martinez, which is coming up fairly shortly for our next episode.
Okay.
But Michael Corley will record a 12-minute recap of one particular issue, and then he'll have dramatic readings. And Sarah, you and I have been on quite a few at this point.
Well, Brian Sims here listens to VoxBox Comic Book Podcast, and he said that he really likes the show.
Now, this is going to be episode number 65, so look for it on iTunes. Brian Sims on Scopewalker. Brian Sims, have
yes.
you heard this latest episode number 65 on the VoxBox Star Wars Comic Book Podcast?
Okay,
you
yes.
did? All right. What did you think about our performance? So Brian Sims has heard it.
Oh, Radio Free Endor has heard it.
All right. Good deal. Awesome sometimes.
All right.
Is that awesome when we're on it or awesome when we're not on it?
All the time. Okay. All right.
All right. So listen up to episode 65 of the VoxBox Star Wars comic book podcast. Now, coming up this week, we're going to talk with our good friend and co-founder of the Fandom Podcast Network, Kevin Raider Nerd Reitzel. Now, if you watch the Mark Hamill panel from the Star Wars Celebration Europe convention, he was the very first one to ask Mark a question.
And we noticed right away he was wearing a special shirt.
Mm-hmm.
He was wearing...
Scopewalkers, do you know what shirt Kevin was wearing? All right, for those of you who guessed a Hoojib shirt, well, you were correct. And 100% cotton shirt, that is correct. Oh, someone already guessed Hoojib. All right, good deal. He was wearing a Hoojib shirt, so big props to our man Kevin. Now, we're also going to talk with Skywalking Through Neverland roving reporter Kai Charles, who just got back from San Diego Comic-Con. And she's got some great stories about a few of the Star Wars panels and the HerUniverse fashion show,
which I was extremely excited to talk about. Now, we also have a Skywalker story from Rune Marchant, shoutouts, and Skywalker of the Week. Oh, but do not forget, we also have Things We Want to Share.
Dun, 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 dun. Things we want to share. Things we want to share. Things we want to share.
So after getting so much hate mail, I finally buckled down and watched Firefly.
And hate tweets
and hate
everything.
And people saying, Rich, we can't believe you haven't seen Firefly.
I know.
You know what? Under the radar, I don't know how.
I don't know how either, because I have the DVD.
After so many people couldn't believe I haven't seen Firefly. It's like, and I know it's a cult favorite show, but I for some reason,
I just never connected
with it.
Right.
But it's summertime. There's a lack of TV shows on. So let's pop the DVDs in and let her go. Oh, hold on. I got to say hello to my sister, Lisa.
Yay.
Hey, Lisa. Breaking news, someone says. Rich gives into the dark side.
That's Brian Sims. Yes.
All right.
Aww.
So I'm really enjoying the show.
Yeah, we're in episode 4.
No, actually we're on episode 2.
Bushwhacked.
Because I looked. Check this out. I have the. I knew you were going to say that.
Serenity is like the movie.
Yeah. See, we just watched Serenity. We just watched The Train Job. No, we just watched Bushwhacked,
which is episode 3.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense.
No. I'm sorry. No, check it out, because this one, Serenity, was on in December, whereas the one we just watched, Bushwhacked, was on in September, which is the second show.
So, but number, it says
we're on episode. This is, look at that over here. Okay, that's the episode number right there.
But okay. What is 1H79?
I don't. That's a production code. So we're on the episode Shindig. All right, that is going to be episode number 3. But let's just say whatever episode number that we're on. Okay. I'm really enjoying this show. I can see why it was canceled.
Really?
Yeah, because it's a show that was just ahead of its time.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
And I can see why it was never brought back, because of the production value is very independent. And the cutting style is very independent. It's a show that, like Arrested Development, it's just not – it's not a show you can sit down and it's just going to be eye candy or brain fodder, something you really have to pay attention to.
Well, kind of like Game of Thrones. I mean, all those different characters in there, you really have to pay attention.
Well, right, but the style of this show is very much like an independent film.
Oh, okay, whereas Game of Thrones is very cinematic.
Right, very, very linear.
Mm.
But this here, they'll cut back and forth. They'll cut back and forth to memories or just what someone else is thinking at the time. So it's a very internal and external show at the same time. So I can see where if you're just tuning into this brand new show, it might jar you. You might not know what's going on.
Yes.
So they're taking a lot of chances with these first episodes that we had seen. So I can see why it just didn't last.
Okay.
But
you know why I think it didn't last?
Why?
Because the higher-ups in charge of what shows are canceled or not canceled were probably mostly men and didn't get that Nathan Fillion is hot.
Well, come on, look at Morena Baccarin. Come
well,
on,
that too, I know.
There you go. There's a woman there. But like a lot of shows, it, you know, if this show were on in the 90s, mm-hmm. it'd be like six seasons in. But now they only aired 11 of the 14 produced episodes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and the rest were all released on DVD. Mm-hmm. I don't know if Sci-Fi Channel had released them later on, but as for Fox, just 11. And they said, you know, no way, because the highest it got in the Nielsen's ratings was number 98.
Okay.
At that point, you just pull the plug. I didn't know about the cast. I didn't know yes. Alan Tudyk was in this. Mm-hmm. If I had known Alan Tudyk was in this, I would have probably tuned in a week earlier.
Right.
And let's see here. Ron Glass from... Okay, Scope Walkers, where do we know Ron Glass from? What series in the 1970s? Let's see if anyone can get this. Now, Ron Glass, to me, he was a staple on the show Barney Miller. Oh, someone just guessed Barney Miller.
Wonjon Jedi.
Yeah. So when I saw him in this, I thought, they're really pulling from a lot of acting styles.
Okay.
So that was a lot of fun to watch because I hadn't seen Ron Glass in something in quite a while. Adam Baldwin, always glad to see him. However, I don't know why his name is Jane.
Oh!
That just keeps throwing me off.
I think that's his last name, and that's just,
no,
you know.
His name is Jane Cobb.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh.
So, when they call him Jane, that's another jarring moment.
And he's like the muscle, so it's just ultra weird.
Yeah. So, Skywalkers, I'm finally jumping on board here to the Firefly bandwagon and, and having a great time with it. And I really appreciate Joss Whedon's independent style on this. But I think it was that style that got the show canceled. It was a show way too ahead of its time.
Right.
So, Scope Walkers, what's your impression on Firefly? Is this one of those universally loved series?
When my dad says you should watch Firefly... When my dad is recommending TV series to me, then yeah, it's a good show.
Okay. Well, I'm very interested to see where this is going to go and where they take it, knowing that in a show like this, kind of like the Planet of the Apes TV series, as the first season goes along, the ratings aren't getting any better. They start pulling back on the budget, and it's very apparent.
Right.
Like when each shot is extended to like a minute of a character running. Because they need to pad out the episode. Huh. That's when you know the budget is starting to dwindle.
Oh. Well, Wonjon Jedi is saying that we should watch Con Man after.
Is that a series or is that a film?
That was my question.
All right. Well, we'll find out soon enough.
Yes.
All right. Now that I got that settled and taken care of,
yes.
So people can stop tweeting me that, Rich, I can't believe you haven't seen Firefly. I'm now watching Firefly.
Oh, Con Man is a web-funded series by Alan Tudyk.
Okay, put that on the list.
Yeah, I already wrote it down.
All right, now let's get into something that was just confirmed at San Diego Comic-Con.
That's right. So Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout will be coming to DCA summer 2017, and it will basically take over what is now the Tower of Terror. All right. So, of course, now whenever something is changing at Disneyland or DCA, heaven forbid, people are like, oh my God, don't change it. Boo. No.
But were we ever really excited about Twilight Zone?
Well, see, that's the thing. Like, I've only seen maybe 1.5 episodes, and I do like the ride. The ride is fun, but I think it's more about the drop and those, you know, the feelings that you get doing the ride. I never really... You know, the overlay of the Twilight Zone was never my pulling point, if you will.
That could be even a secret squirrel ride, and it wouldn't matter because all we're really interested in is the fun drop.
Right, exactly.
So the theme of it can change, but you put a theme in like Guardians of the Galaxy?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness.
And the fact that what they're going to be doing is you're going to be walking into the collector's collecting space, like his warehouse. So you get to see some of this stuff up close and personal. So I am super excited about that.
Yeah. Now let's roll into a clip by Joe Rohde, who is a Walt Disney Imagineer, who tells us all about this amazing ride.
Hi, I'm Joe Rohde, and I'm here to tell you about this exciting new addition to Disney California Adventure. Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout. It takes you into the world of Guardians of the Galaxy in this really immersive, exciting experience that features the really quirky and beloved characters from the film in a whole new narrative that no one's ever seen. We're working with everybody on this, with Joe Quesada and Kevin Feige. We've got James Gunn, the director from the film. And it's this incredible team of people coming together to make this really, really exciting attraction. The setting is a kind of warehouse fortress power plant where the collector keeps all of the objects that he's brought from all around the universes. Once we enter, we're kind of in a museum. All this stuff is all around us in cases, in vitrines, and in there now, imprisoned, are the Guardians of the Galaxy. Rocket is enlisting our aid in helping the Guardians break out of this place. This all leads to the same kind of like insanely fun rocketing up and down ride experience that we have today. But the framing and the setting and the pacing and the timing all completely altered to feed this really very funny, very exciting, very irreverent story.
Now, this really reminds me of the Back to the Future ride.
Okay, why is that?
Because here, Rocket escapes and he's trying to enlist the help of the passengers, the riders, to help free the Guardians of the Galaxy.
Right.
Whereas the Back to the Future ride, it was Doc who was trying to enlist the help of the passengers because Biff has done something. I think he was stealing plutonium.
Of course, that Biff.
And so he needed the help of the riders, which I think is a fun theme to really immerse yourself into this world.
Yeah, and engage the audience.
So it's borrowing from that, but who cares? It's fun. We get to talk to Rocket.
Yes.
That's a lot of fun.
There's two exciting things for me. Can I go into that?
Oh, please.
Okay. So one thing that's exciting is that, like Star Tours, you will get different rides each time. So something different may happen, and there's different music. They're going to use the Rock soundtrack. Like, how cool is that? I'm so excited about that. And then at the very end of the Disney Parks blog post, it mentioned that this new Guardians of the Galaxy ride marks the beginning of some more Marvel in DCA, like a Marvel area.
Okay, let me
that's exciting.
I'll just put this out there now.
Okay.
I think we're done with Bug's Life.
Well, don't have kids.
I know.
So we don't know, but that whole area back there with like the Mike and Sully ride.
Oh, come on.
That we haven't gone on in a couple years. Like that needs to go.
That was outdated the day it went up.
Yeah. there's that whole Warehouse 17 back there and all kinds of things they could do in that Hollywoodland space that would really expand that area and make it more Guardians.
Yeah.
More
Marvel.
More Marvel, exactly.
You know, true. Now, there's a lot of complaining.
I know.
Hold on to something. There's a lot of complaining out there.
Yeah, so we want to go into some of the comments that we saw on Facebook. Dave Parfit of Adventures by Daddy, he had posted this article of Guardians of the Galaxy and asked people's opinions on Facebook. And as expected, there's a great range of opinions. So right off the bat, he got two people saying boo and hate it, you know, that there's a Guardians of the Galaxy overlay. However, there were some interesting comments here. So I'm going to read a few of these.
Okay.
So Lisa Arendt says, of all the lousy ways to make a buck, they could have kept the Art Deco haunted theme and taken out the mentions of the Twilight Zone.
Because the Twilight Zone license is lapsing this year.
Yes. So they had to do something. And she goes on to say, there are plenty of areas in DCA that could use a facelift. This does nothing to help with crowds. If it were a seasonal overlay, I would be fine with it. Disney needs to add things, not just make a commercial out of all attractions. Okay.
Darn them for wanting to commercialize their property.
Yeah.
Darn those people.
Now, what I find interesting about this is if you think about it, some of the very first dark rides at Disneyland, say Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, Pinocchio ride, there's a ton of those dark rides that are based on movies that Disney has done and characters that they have promoted.
Pretty much these theme parks are a big commercial for their films.
Right.
And the problem with that is...
Oh, and Peter Pan, and exactly.
Peter Pan, look at them all.
Yeah. So to me, that argument doesn't hold up. And yes, it's a new property, Guardians of the Galaxy. Well, technically new to Disney because Guardians of the Galaxy itself, as a comic book, has been around for quite a while, correct?
Oh, yeah, over 40 years.
Yeah, right. So it's not like it's...
But I don't understand people who always say, well, they're trying to make a quick buck. They just want to make some money. They're a business.
Yes.
That's their model, to make money.
I mean, that's why Disney Infinity was canceled, because of the business model wasn't working.
Right, it wasn't progressing.
I mean, yes, as much as Disney has that whole theme behind it of magic and family, overall, it is a business, unfortunately. So.
I never understood the whole Twilight Zone thing. It wasn't a Disney property.
Why do they have that IP?
Does it have?
Right.
Right. Mm. Right. So it was fun while it lasted, but you know what? Out with the old, in with the new. And this ride is going to tie in with the opening of Guardians of the Galaxy 2, which opens May 5th, 2017.
Ooh, yes.
So that summer, we will see the ride, which will be so exciting, because I never understood why Disney couldn't connect the ride openings with a film that was coming out, like Cars 2. Cars Land opened like a year after Cars 2 opened. And I know they have these things planned years and years in advance.
Right, right.
Well, people are going to go anyway, but why not tie it in to the opening? So I am thrilled about that, and I'm thrilled to see the collector's warehouse.
Yeah, I know. That's exciting.
Because you know who we're going to see in the collector's warehouse?
Howard the Duck.
That's it. No more Mr. Nice Duck.
And I just want to see an animatronic. Oh, of course, you're going to have Howard the Duck.
What about Cosmo? I want to see Cosmo.
Cosmo, yeah, of course, of course. I just want some love for Howard the Duck, which we will be doing next week.
Next week. Can we go into what Dave Parfitt said about Guardians of the Galaxy?
Yeah.
Okay. He wrote, okay, I know I should have a strong opinion one way or another, but I'm indifferent. I liked The Twilight Zone, but it doesn't ring Disney to me. So he has kind of the same opinion as you. I never really understood why Twilight Zone was in a Disney park. My kids never even knew what Twilight Zone was. That is a good point there. That being said, Guardians of the Galaxy is still too new to me to know whether it will be a property that stands the test of time. Huh.
Well, the fact that they can keep changing out the video and the ride.
Yes.
That's cool. That will stand the test of time.
And the music, too. And I like the fact they kind of alluded to the fact that you'll be dropping to the music or something, like to the beat of the music.
Well, and the fact that the Guardians will be... little by little integrating themselves into the whole Marvel Avengers universe. Mm-hmm. So this can really change into an Avengers ride and just show the whole scope of the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Awesome.
So the possibilities are infinite.
Absolutely.
Was it MGM related, says Mrs. Reb W. Yeah. of Twilight Zone?
That's a good question.
Yeah. Maybe it was. So that's why they... connected that property.
Lady Hanna Solo brings up a good point. Now, we do want to bring up the point that Twilight Zone Tower of Terror will only be changing at DCA and Disneyland Resort. The Tower of Terror, as it stands right now, will not change at Walt Disney World. Though if they are losing the IP for Twilight Zone, I don't know if they'll be changing up a little bit the ride.
Yeah, sometimes those contracts are really weird where
it'll
lapse in one park but not the other.
Yeah, like especially Marvel stuff will, I believe, only be able to be integrated in the West Coast parks.
Yeah, I don't understand how all that works, but sorry people in Florida.
Yeah, no Marvel for you.
I'm sure they're going to be integrating this very soon because they're not going to have this huge property just be in one park and not the other. But the Tower of Terror in Florida at Walt Disney World is much different.
It's a better ride.
It is a better ride, but it's not like they can just take the specs and designs from the one here at DCA and overlap it in the one at Walt Disney World.
Right.
Because there's so much more to change out. But I'm sure it will be coming to a theme park near you, our Floridian Skywalkers.
Either that or you'll just have to visit Disneyland Resort.
Don't worry, we will Periscope the opening for you. All right, so let's close out things we want to share and move on to our conversation about Star Wars Celebration Europe with our good friend, Kevin Raider Nerd Reitzel. I just pulled a Peter Brady and my voice cracked.
Yes, you did.
When it's time to change, then it's time to change. tight to tie, come along for the ride. Don't you see? When it's time to change, you've got to rearrange who you are into what you're gonna be.
Skywalking to celebration
in Europe.
Star Wars celebration. Let's celebrate.
On the last episode of Skywalking Through Neverland, we got an exciting first-hand recap of Star Wars Celebration Europe from Trisha Barr. This week, our coverage continues with our good friend, co-founder of the Fandom Podcast Network, and the man who was the first person up to ask Mark Hamill a question during his one-man show.
Everyone please say hello to Kevin Raider Nerd Reitzel.
Hey, Kevin.
Hey, guys, how are you? Exciting to be back on. I missed you guys.
I know. We didn't miss you, but that's not the right way of saying it. We actually loved seeing all your pictures, so we didn't miss you at all because we saw you a lot.
We saw you a lot during the last couple of weeks because you were posting like a fiend.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. The feedback that I was getting on the post, not just from Celebration, but from my trip, I was having people say, please do more, please do more. And I'm like, you sure you're not getting sick of me already? All right, here I go.
Every couple of seconds, there's another update from Kevin. Where's Kevin's on Act 2 now, and Kevin's at Celebration Europe. Kevin's standing on Stonehenge.
Where in the world is Kevin Raider Nerd Reitzel?
So you were just everywhere. My God. How long were you gone? Like a year?
It felt like it, but I was gone for 19 days,
Whoa.
Just short of 3 weeks.
Wow.
And it was the longest trip I've done and by far the best trip I've ever done.
Wow. I couldn't even imagine being gone from home that long. How nice was it to just sleep in your own bed again, though?
Oh, my gosh. Of all the B&Bs and traveling that I did with my good friend David before we met up with our main group for Star Wars Celebration, just remember when you're making reservations, when you request a double bed, it is not two twin beds. It is one double-size bed. And
so
we had to kind of work around that, but we learned a lot on the road, and I've done a lot of traveling, so we were able, and we both were done a lot of traveling together, so we made the best of it. It was a lot of fun.
I'm picturing a scene from Trains, Planes, and Automobiles right now.
Where's your other hand? Between two pillows. Those aren't pillows.
Yep, that pretty much sums it up.
Oh, nice. Now, in Ireland, do they drive on the wrong side of the road as well?
Yeah, when you go to the rental car company, it's very funny. There's a nice big sticker on what we would say is our driver's side, but is the passenger side, and it says, drive on the left side.
I don't even think I would want to attempt to drive in Europe, because I'd be too afraid.
Yeah.
I'd be too afraid of going on the wrong side of the road, and yeah, we all know what happened when Matthew Broderick did that. All right, let's push ahead to Celebration Europe. Now, if you could describe this convention in one word, what would it be?
I'm going to say two words, and that would be family reunion.
Aww.
You know what? That's one word because it's hyphened.
Yeah. Well, the one thing I wanted to say was that these conventions, as I get older, they take on a different meaning and different priorities. Before, it was all about getting swag and exclusives and autographs. This one and the last one, it's more about meeting up with people you haven't seen before and also making new friends. And that's what it means to me.
You know what?
I totally agree.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I know, like previous celebrations, I had always been like, oh, have to go see the Mark Hamill panel or the Carrie Fisher panel. And now as it gets further along and you've been to more of these panels, it's like, well, you know, let's let new people experience that for the first time. And I'll go over here to this interesting panel or meet some friends.
So, I think like now in the generation of podcasting and social media, it's all about the reunion. And like you said, the family reunion. I love the way you put that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I learned that lesson through Celebration Anaheim. Mm. I really came away a lot with that experience. And, you know, and a lot has to do with, remember that wrap up show that we did with you guys, you know, and finally, and getting together and realizing what we had done together and how important that was to all of us, and how we look fondly, we look back on that. And now I know that I can do the same thing with Celebration London in Europe here. So, yeah.
Nice. You knew at that roundtable discussion that we had at the very end of Celebration Europe.
Anaheim,
right. You knew that you were going to Celebration Europe even back then.
Yep, exactly.
How would you compare Celebration Anaheim to Celebration Europe?
God, they're different for so many reasons. You know, when it comes to the way things are, you know, kind of done, but then there's a lot of similarities when it comes to meeting and connecting with people. But my, you know, I mentioned this, I think actually in one of your threads, Richard, on Skywalking Through Neverland. If you had to pull one complaint out of me when it came to, and the difference when it came to the celebrations in Europe, is they're only 3 days. Mm-hmm. They're not 4 days. And that was my one complaint with Celebration London in Europe. And I also went to Celebration in Germany, the Celebration 2, was that it was also 3 days. This convention was awesome in London, but it was too big for 3 days. It needs to be 4 days. And that's the only thing that I would love to see these European celebrations do, because 4 days is just about right for Star Wars celebrations, and especially since Star Wars is just getting bigger and bigger by the day.
Yeah, you know what? I'm glad you brought that up, because I had seen so many complaints about Celebration Europe. I just couldn't believe people are still complaining. You give them what they want, and they're going to complain they didn't get one thing or another. But people, focus on what you have, not what you don't have. And I think maybe you can say it could have been 4 days, it could have been 5 days, it could have been 1,000 days. But I like when you say that it could have been a fourth day, because that's not really a complaint. That's more of a, hey, I wish we want more Star Wars.
Right.
Well, you know, I remember the episode you guys did about preparing for a convention and you know, what you need to do. You have to have a plan A, a plan B, and a plan C. And I knew I wasn't going to be able to do everything, but I had my priorities. My priorities were panels this time, and of course, the costuming that I was doing with the 501st and Rebel Legion. Those were my priorities, and I'm very happy that I was able to do that. I didn't get a chance to go on the floor as much as I want to. I got my prints that I needed to. I got onto the Celebration store for the amount of time that I was there for. So, you know, obviously I didn't get to see everything, but I didn't have my heart set on everything. I had to be realistic about it, and I did plan ahead for it. And I learned that through experience.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, I know. My primary goal at conventions was to always go to the floor. I just wanted to go to the floor. And it wasn't until Sarah and I got together and I realized she didn't really have an interest in the floor. And she wanted to go see panels. And I'm thinking, panels? what are you talking about? And then she said, I want to go see this person speak. Speak? Yeah, no, this is where you buy things. And
I'm never interested in buying that kind of stuff.
And we ended up going to a couple of panels because Sarah really wanted to go to them. And it's like, oh, now my interest has shifted. And sometimes I don't even see the show floor anymore. And we're going to panels. And like you said at the top of this segment, that it's all about the family reunion. So I think at Celebration Orlando, we're going to be just focusing on, let's get together with this person, with that person. Let's meet up here, meet up there. Let's record this. Let's do this round table.
I think we were at the very first panel for Star Wars Rebel, or not Star Wars Rebels, the Clone Wars.
Yeah.
In 2009.
Yeah, that same time we had met James Arnold Taylor, and he recorded an outgoing voice message for us.
Yeah, and Dave Filoni was at that panel. It was really interesting.
Yeah.
Well, like I alluded to earlier, is that, you know, your interest can change, whether it's, you know, your own personal things or influence from someone you care about. And I used to always be about the autographs, and I spent a lot of money on autographs in the past. And I'm proud to say I didn't spend any money on autographs this time. Uh-huh. The one autograph I got for free was from Mark Hamill by asking him a question.
That's so cool.
So I'm going to guess that was your favorite panel, the Mark Hamill one-man show?
You know what's funny? I got to tell you, I originally was not planning on going to that panel. Because my main priority for that day, Friday, was the Rogue One, because there was mystery behind it. I had seen Mark Hamill before in panels. I had gotten his autograph. I've met him several times. But they had the weird line kind of cue system, which did work. You have to show up early at 6 in the morning when they were giving them out to get into the actual celebration stage. And everyone – there was a bigger line for Rogue One, and we were all hoping that we could get it because we weren't sure at the time how many seats were in there. Mm-hmm. But a funny thing happened. My friend was in the Mark Hamill one. I was in the Rogue One. We were all getting our bracelets, but the weird thing started happening where everyone in the Rogue One started going around into the Mark Hamill line, and everyone in the Mark Hamill line, after getting their bracelet, went around to the Rogue One because you were allowed at least 2 bracelets a day.
Wow.
And so I wasn't planning on it. I had a Wilroy Hood run scheduled in between those, so it worked out. I'm like, you know what? I want to hang out with my friend David. I'm going to go to the Mark Hamill panel after all.
Aww.
Nice. Now, what is your secret tip to being number one at the microphone?
Oh, okay. Okay, here's how that worked out. It was a cross between opportunity and initiative. When we got – yeah, I'm serious. I know it sounds silly.
No, that sounds awesome.
Here's the thing. You got to kind of keep your eyes open when stuff starts to happen. You could be excited and kind of sit in your chair and be distracted by a lot of things. But we decided, like, are we going to go to the floor first and then get in line for Mark Hamill? We decided, let's get in line for Mark Hamill in the queue for when they start letting us in the theater, we'll have a pretty good seat somewhere. Mm. And that's exactly what we did. We were up kind of near the first 50 to 60 people. And if you watch the panel, you'll notice there's a big front section, big square section of seats that is flanked on the left and the right by aisles. And then behind you, the main aisle where people are kind of deciding whether they want to go towards the front or towards the back. And I was with my good friends and Riley Blanton from the Star Wars Report. We got the back left corner of the section, which was great because it was right near the aisle. And also I noticed that there was a microphone stand set up there. Oh. And on the other opposite aisle, there was another microphone stand. And so I'm looking at going, okay, I know where this is going to go. I'm kind of curious. And then I heard some of the people with headphones that were kind of monitoring the lines and the audio feed. They're saying, okay, this is where the questions and answering are going to be. You know, Mark Hamill will take the questions from the audience here. And I thought and by the way, this is when it was about maybe a few minutes before Mark Hamill's come on. You had DJ Elliott and Mark Daniels warming up the crowd, getting ready. People were getting sitting down. And no one was going up to these microphones. And I immediately walked up to the microphone, stood right there. And as soon as I did, everyone else started getting behind me and getting on the other one. And the person that was ahead, had the little headset, said, okay, you're going to be the first question when Mark starts asking. And I'm like, okay.
Excellent.
And then I realized I had no idea what I was going to ask him. I'm sitting there. Mark is introduced. And he's kind of doing, you know, he comes out. He didn't have any interviewer. He wanted to come out and kind of do it free form. He had a wireless mic. He had a little director's chair to sit on. And he kind of wanted to do it his way and kind of do his little introduction. Now, still, I have no idea what I'm going to ask him. And I didn't want to ask him something kind of – I didn't want to ask him like the typical questions that were followed up later on or stuff that he's asked a million times before. And then I realized I had the perfect question to ask him.
Oh, you are the perfect podcaster. that'll always happen to me. I'll raise my hand for a Q&A. I'm thinking, what am I going to ask? it's just that reflex.
Yeah, you do.
In hoping sometimes they don't pick me first. I'll be going, you know what? It all started back in 1977. And my head's reeling for that question. Now, tell everyone what your question was.
Okay, well, after Mark kind of did his little opening, he threw some jokes out there. He was warming up the crowd, too. It was great. He said, okay, let's go to questions. And now keep in mind, I forgot that this thing was being streamed worldwide.
Oh.
I had no idea. And if you look closely, I'm wearing a certain Skywalking Through Neverland t-shirt. I'm wearing a Team Hoojib shirt that I was proud to put, and I had several people ask me about the t-shirt, so I was excited about that.
Right on.
But when the question came, I said, you know what? Something happened to me personally, and it is related to what – because Mark Hamill had just announced that he can't talk about episode 8, and he kind of joked about that. But he says, hey, I could talk about episodes 1 through 7. And so I said, well, I got the perfect question. I said, Mark?
First of all, thank you very much for being here, Star Wars Celebration. We're all really excited. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, my gosh. Thank you so much.
I got one question for you. I had a scheduled trip to land on Skellig Michael with a boat ride last week, but it was canceled due to weather.
Yeah.
Wondering if you had a couple of canceled trips to Skellig Michael before you shot your scene.
We got really lucky with the weather, and you never know. You know, this is a country where you get all four seasons in one day. It's sunny in the morning, then it rains, and we had sleet one day out at Pinewood. Are you kidding me? Sleet? Yeah. We got very lucky with the weather, because basically you have to sit around and hope that the lights come through and it's okay. Did you go to the top?
No, I didn't get it, but we did get a boat ride around
it. It's brutal. You just keep climbing and climbing and climbing and climbing. They cut out all the bits of Daisy, because it took her about 4 hours to get to me, by the way. They said, we'll just cut out this part, just get her up the mountain faster, because people will be bored, they'll be running out to get popcorn.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next question. Give that man a picture.
But I had to ask him, because talking to the locals there at Skellig Michael, the weather is unpredictable. The day before was absolutely beautiful. And then our day was horrible. It was rain. There was choppy weather. And then the day after, when we tried to get on, because they have a line of up to 50 people, hopefuls, to try and get on Skellig Michael, hoping that people will drop out and not get on there. It was beautiful that day, you know? So. Yeah, my one recommendation is, if you want to do Skellig Michael, plan a year in advance. Plan 3 straight days. Plan on being there for 3 or 4 days. And if you happen to get on the first day, by all means, do it.
Yeah. Well, wow.
Now, did he happen to mention anything about his slightly slurred speech? It almost sounded like he came back from the dentist and his jaw hadn't recovered from the Novocaine.
I've seen him do those before. I think he was really excited and he was kind of caught up in the moment. And even though you're a professional and you've done this a million times before, you still get caught up in the excitement and you kind of might be trying to, you know, you might be slurring it a little bit. And he was also eating something. He brought out a little, like, these little Star Wars graham cracker snacks, too. And so there was a combination of that as well. I could tell he was nervous, even though he's done this a million times before. And I've talked in front of people, done speeches. There's always this natural nervousness. So that's kind of what I chalked it up to. Plus, you know, he did have a mouthful of graham crackers.
Did anyone else bring this up later on? Was this addressed?
No, not that I've seen. People were just more excited. I think he started to get into his groove once after my question, several others. He started to sound more like himself, and then he started really getting excited about asking the question. So that's my take on it anyway.
I loved how he would alternately sit and then get up and walk around and be all energized. I thought that was really fun.
Do you think maybe he was nervous meeting you?
Well, because that was the first question, and you know, this kind of format that he did, I think he's still kind of working out the way that he handles it. And I just believe he was nervous as well, you know, because he doesn't – think about it. This is his first major appearance after episode 7, so he's going to get new questions that he probably is not prepared for. A lot of them I'm sure that he has, but I didn't know if he was expecting a question about Skellig Michael and weather. You know, it's, you know, more like he was probably expecting questions about, you know, who's Ray's father and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. You know, here I go throwing out a weather question.
Yeah.
But if you zoom into his mouth really tight, you can actually read his lips and he's saying, is that Kevin Rader nerd Reitzel? I kid you not.
The big surprise about that was that as I was starting to walk away, he says, give that man an autograph picture. He was giving out autograph pictures to everyone that answered a question. And the assistant said, hey, here's your picture. And I almost tripped over the mic trying to get it.
Oh, of course.
Luckily, that wasn't caught on video because I've watched the video and I didn't see that. But I was very appreciative to get that. And I had people coming up to saying, you're so lucky you got that, because I've had to pay close to 200 pounds to get his autograph today.
Right. Oh, my goodness. Well, speaking of new questions that Mark Hamill got, you know, someone asked what he thought of his role in The Force Awakens. Well, it sounds like they didn't tell him what Luke would be doing, or maybe they didn't even know.
I don't think they prepared me correctly. You know, in other words, you know, I went to training and, you know, I lost all this weight and did all these things. And I thought, I must be doing something physical if they're sending me to the gym twice a week and torturing me physically. But I think they could have prepared me a little better. It's about preparing you, about saying, oh, by the way, you know all that workout where you lost all the weight? You're going to have to turn and remove your hood. I was like, oh, I got to lie down for a minute. Oh.
Now, do you think maybe they didn't even know what Luke was going to be doing in The Force Awakens?
No, I think they, thinking about behind the scenes, I think they were calculating this from day one all the way through. Because if you think about it, even though they had a pretty good idea of how little screen time he was going to have, he had to look good.
Yeah.
Plus, they go through the costume photo shoots beforehand so they can release press when they're ready to do that. And they want to make sure that obviously he's ready and he stays in this routine for episode 8, which I'm sure he's going to have a little more lines to say. But as for him talking about being prepared and they could have like let him know, I'm sure it would have probably been advantageous if he had gotten a call from, from director J.J. Abrams saying, okay, look, before we get into this table read, I got to warn you about something. You're only in the movie for about 30 seconds. We're having you go through this. So I think he probably went through a little bit of, shock because he realized how hard he has been working to get to the physical aspect of it. But they're looking at the long picture here, and they had to have Luke look a certain way. They had to have him, look, the way that he did, and they wanted Mark to make sure that he was used to this routine.
This almost reminds me of the time when they needed Mark for an extra pickup shot for The Empire Strikes Back, but it was the day that his son, Griffin, was going to be born.
Oh.
He's like, guys, my son is going to be born any minute now. But Mark, come on down to the studio. It's a quick shot. You'll be in and out in no time. So he raced down to the studio, and he's getting all prepared. He's all antsy. And one of the grips mentions, you know what? They could have put a monkey in the suit, and you never would have known it. He's like, what are you talking about? Yeah, this is an extreme long shot. We're never going to see your face.
Yeah, and I'm also thinking, too, that they may have had to reshoot scenes with him later on, like they've been doing with Rogue One now, and they wanted to make sure that he looked the same in his face. You know, he didn't put on any extra weight or lose any extra weight. They wanted to make sure that if they do need to do any reshoots, he was looking the same way he was before.
And honestly, right before The Force Awakens, he was packing on some pounds.
Oh, really?
So maybe it was like one of these, you know what, we don't really need him to lose weight because he's wearing a robe, but for his own health, let's get him to the gym. Now, Mark had a great theory. I'm going to call him Mark because we're good friends. Mark had a good theory.
That's fine with me because we are as well. So
yes.
He had a great theory of when he thought Luke should have made his entrance into The Force Awakens. Check this out.
But I loved everything in 7. Because when I sat down to read it, you should have seen me. What's the very first words in the crawl? Luke Skywalker has vanished. I said, oh, this is going to be good. I'm reading. I'm making notes every time everyone says, Skywalker must be stopped. Page 34. The sword of Skywalker is powerful. Page 77. So I have this long list. And, I'll tell you where I thought I came in. In the forest, when the lightsaber goes like this and flies off, I said, oh, what a great entrance. Ah! Ray caught it? She hasn't even been to Dagobah for training. What's the deal? I know. Everyone said... You didn't finish your training either, so you have no room to talk. I was a Jedi school dropout, but I had to get back to my friends.
So did that idea excite you?
Oh, it totally did. I was laughing because when he was describing about, making his entrance where Rey uses the Force to grab the lightsaber, and this is Luke's lightsaber last, lost on Cloud City. How great would it have been to have a little reunion with that lightsaber going, it's back, I got it back. And I could see him, patiently looking through the script whenever a Skywalker's name was announced again, and having him talk about that, even though looking back now, would not fit into the script or the storyline because, you know, Rey, that's Rey's moment there, and that's the moment that we all got caught up in. But it was great for him to speculate on that.
Yeah, I'm visualizing that shot in my head where he grabs the lightsaber and Rey looks over, and there's Luke standing there as if he'd been standing there the whole time and just feeling Rey out. How far can she get? And she might be in trouble. And I know Yoda said, you know what, just leave it alone. It's up to them to do what they can do and don't interfere. However, I've got to step in here. So it would have been a great visual moment, but it would have taken away that moment from Rey.
Yeah, well, taken away
Mark's,
a lot.
Mark's a good storyteller, and for him to share that that would have been a great entry point was fun to hear him speculate on.
If you leave now, help them you could, but you would destroy it all for what they had fought and suffered, which I thought is a brilliant line, and he would have destroyed everything that Rey had been building up to. So in the bigger picture, it wouldn't have worked story-wise, but just to see that visual of a cloaked man with a mechanical hand standing in the woods, grabbing the lightsaber, it ignites, and you see Luke's bearded face.
But for the record, I'm really glad that Rey caught it.
Me too.
Oh, yeah, it couldn't go any other way. It could, but maybe if Luke had helped the lightsaber into Rey's hand.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know.
I mean, we can't rewrite The Force Awakens because it was perfect the way it was. But when he said that, my head blew up.
Being there in person, it was as you can imagine, that roar of cheer of like, yes, that would have been great, you know, and the fans were supporting that theory. It was good energy in that room when he said that.
Oh yeah. And now, speaking of having Luke more in The Force Awakens, I know way back when there were rumors that the first shot in The Force Awakens was going to be Luke's hand.
Now, these were rumors?
These were rumors way back when. I don't know where someone got this.
I remember that, Richard. I remember hearing those rumors, and it was one of those strong rumors too that people were latching onto, because, you know, we always wanted to know what happened. And when you see in the early trailers and you see Luke's lightsaber make an appearance and you're seeing it in promotional shots, that rumor just went on and on and on. And we now kind of have an idea reason why.
Yeah, and apparently it was more than just a rumor, because here is Mark telling that story.
The original image in Episode 7 was a hand holding a lightsaber flying through space. Can you imagine that? Because that would have been, I would have been in the first shot and the last shot. Perfect symmetry. But I said, what happened to that? You know, because it goes flying, 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 and the flesh burns away and the bones fall and it goes, shunk, you know, into the surface of Jakku. See, I know a little bit about Star Wars. It's Jakku. But for some reason, they decided not to do that. And so I'm reading. Where is Luke? Everybody's talking about me. It's the most elaborate entrance in the history of show business. And then it's over. You show up, turn around, pull down your hood. You don't even know it's really literally a cliffhanger. That's what I love, the visual pun of him standing on a cliff. Did you get that? Subtle. And someone said to me, is that a gravestone next year? You remember that question? I don't know. It looked like a rock to me. But I love it. I love you people, you know, knowing so much and being so focused on every minute detail. And then, of course, the disappointment in your faces when you actually meet me and I have no idea what you're talking about.
Boy, what an actor. Where am I? There I am. Nope, that's not me. Where am I?
All right, so I have a question, though. When he's talking about this first shot that supposedly was supposed to be there, or they were thinking of, the lightsaber goes flying to Jakku? What's he talking about?
Yeah, it's flying. His severed hand flying through space, and when it enters the atmosphere of Jakku, all the flesh burns and the bones turn to brittle, and the lightsaber just lands on the sands of Jakku.
Why would his hands be flying to Jakku.
That's why they didn't use it.
Okay.
It just happened to be right in the trajectory, I guess, beneath the Bespin system. Yeah.
What?
Yeah, that once again, that's why they didn't use it.
Okay, good.
But yeah, I remember everyone talking about that, and I was thinking, huh, visually it's interesting, but how long has it been floating out there in space, gripped onto this lightsaber?
Right.
It was just nice to have Mark Hamill confirm that that was in the original script after hearing these rumors and seeing a rumor like that actually coming to fruition, that it was true, but just happened to be changed.
Oh. Yeah. And I love his whole analysis of the actual cliffhanger. That was brilliant. See, Han Solo isn't the only one who can have a cliffhanger.
Yeah, you know, when he's talking about the gravestone, I there's a part of me when he said that is kind of wondering if he actually does know, but he's just not saying about it. He's just kind of playing it off right now. I could just speculating, but, you know, he says, is it a gravestone? I have no idea. He does know for sure.
I don't think he would have brought it up if he knew what it was.
Well, I think at this point, is episode 8 done shooting?
Yes.
It just wrapped up today, according to Facebook.
All right, so if it is a gravestone, we probably would have found out in episode 8, so he probably knows.
Oh, yeah, he would know by now.
If it meant anything.
Right, so, yeah, I just realized that, too, so, darn.
Yeah. So maybe that means it doesn't mean anything.
No, it has to mean something.
I don't know. It was a rock, too.
It was in the shape of a little cross, and I'm not sure they have crosses in the Star Wars universe.
Huh. Okay.
But, yeah, you're right. Now that the fact that he did bring it up, so I don't think it was anything other than just what he said. A rock. Oh, man. Now, Mark Hamill was also asked about his favorite scene in the Star Wars films that he loved to shoot.
Well, you know, that's it. It's so hard to pick just one. People say, what's your favorite Beatles song? I mean, it's hard to pick one, but I love Swinging Across with the Princess. That was so much fun. And they got it in one take. You know, usually you have to do 4, 5, 6, 10 takes. Go back to your trailer and have lunch and we're going to come back and do it again. They got it in one take, 4 cameras running. I was so disappointed because we were in harnesses. It's the same guys that flew Peter Pan, Foils of London. So they said, you want to fly? I said, so much, because, you know, one take. They said, well, unhook them from Carrie, and they flew me all around the set. I mean, it was Peter Pan time. And George was like, get him down. It's an insurance risk. If he hits a wall like Wile E. Coyote, the whole movie's off. There'll be a stain on the wall. But that I loved. I loved the cantina sequence because in the movie like this, you're always wondering, where's the creature going to be? And I guess to a certain extent, there were sand people and there was Jawas and so forth, and there was Darth Vader. Come to think of it, there were a lot of creatures. But my point is, when you walked into that bar, everywhere you looked, I thought that was so novel. An idea to go into a bar where everybody's a creature different from you, except for you.
Now, it's times like this when I start to question everything that I hear, because I had heard conflicting stories about that whole chasm swing.
Oh.
Because apparently, from what I'd heard before, the harness that they were strapped into ripped.
What?
So they were lucky to get that one swing across. But now he's saying that he was swinging around like Peter Pan.
You know, I do remember hearing something about that, Richard, and you might be, I think you're right. I, you know, maybe that's something he chose to not share, but, you know, being able to get that in one take and you're expecting to be flying around, I can understand he could show some disappointment and he was excited if he was able to do that. But I seem to remember that too. There was an issue with the rigging or something like that. Is that what you heard?
Yeah. The harness that the canvas harness that was strapped, that was strapping both of them in right before there were George yelled action, it ripped. They were like, we got to get this done. Just push him over. Send them across, and let's hope that it works. And as soon as they land, get them out of that harness and just dump that thing in the dumpster so no one sees it. So, Kevin, what did you think when you heard the story and you, in the back of your mind, you were thinking, wait a minute, that's not the story I originally heard, so what's really going on?
Well, you know, as these guys go on to do, you know, these shows, they're, you know, I'm sure they're telling the same stories over and over again, but sometimes something might change. It's kind of like when,
you know, you tell a story and it changes, and then someone else tells the story again and it changes. And I'm sure maybe he just remembers it differently, and he just chose not to to say anything about that because, you know, it came across the way that it did great. Maybe there was something wrong with the harness originally, but once they did get it fixed, and then that's how he told that story. But I do remember that, though. I remember that there was an issue with that.
Yeah, and really, I can't see Gary Kurtz or any of the producers letting that happen, because that is an immense insurance risk.
Yeah.
George, I don't think would even care.
On something without a budget.
Yeah. Well, he would care that he's going to lose his main actor.
Well, yeah.
But yeah, that was just one of those, whenever I hear a conflicting story, then I think, oh, what is real? And as we've spoken to some guests from the original trilogy era, they'll say things like, eh, sometimes different people will tell different stories, so you never really know what is the truth unless you were actually there. So whenever I'm hearing stories from way back in the day, I just like, eh, whatever sounds fun, I'll go with.
Yeah, and then you have to keep that in mind, too, when Mark's telling this story. The story went over really great. It was fun to hear him talk right about that. And for people that did not know, like you and I, remembering that, it was great to hear in person. He was excited to talk about it.
Yeah, I can just see Mark Hamill going, off to Neverland!
Let's record him saying that.
If only we had that soundbite.
Let's take a break from our discussion about the Mark Hamill panel from Star Wars Celebration Europe with Kevin Raider-Nerd Reitzel to hear from some other great podcasts.
Forget about whether Han shot first. He did. Is it true that Han Solo teamed up with a 6-foot green rabbit? Did Darth Vader profess a devotion to the immortal gods of the Sith? And did Leia's unhealthy attraction to her brother grow for years? Ew. Hi, I'm voice actor Michael Corley, and I want to answer these questions and more on the Vox Box Star Wars comic book podcast. Each Vox Box episode covers classic Star Wars comics, starting with the original Marvel series in 1977 all the way to the present day. So tune in, have some fun, and may the Force be with you at VoxBoxPodcast.com.
If you love all things Disney, then you're a D-head. And if you're a D-head, this is the show for you. Each and every week, Disney Blue presents Disney On Demand, your free, dedicated Disney podcast hosted by Jonathan Johnson. Every week, Disney Blue relives all the Disney magic, movies, and memories. Every week, you'll hear our celebrity guests who make the magic, your favorite Disney actors, writers, directors, and characters, the best of classic Disney, and breaking news on Disney's latest films, television shows, and theme parks. So put on your ears and give it a little bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. Disney Blue's Disney On Demand is on the air, and it's free. Just go to DizRadio.com. That's DizRadio.com. See you real soon.
And now back to Kevin Raider-Nerd Reitzel and Mark Hamill at the Star Wars Celebration Europe Convention.
Well, let's look ahead to episode 8, because even though Mark Hamill said that he couldn't say anything about episode 8, he kind of said some stuff about episode 8. So let's go to this clip here.
I was looping episode 8 yesterday, and there's dialogue in there. I thought, oh boy, I can already see this on a t-shirt. Seriously. Rian Johnson is amazing. He'll make you forget all about May the Force Be With You. He's come up with so many new catchphrases.
How funny is that? That we got to know that there's awesome catchphrases.
Yeah.
You know what I thought of when I first heard that was he's looping, which means episode 8 is almost done.
Oh.
And that's what came to my head. And, you know, of course, you know, when he was saying that, he's saying there's some great catchphrases. And so he's hit, you know, this is him after shooting all of his scenes, going back into the studio to re-record his dialogue and, you know, revisiting the script again. And so I'm sure that he was having a great time thinking about, boy, this could be something on a t-shirt. And of course, you know, we've got Tell That to Conja Club. We've got We're Home, Chewy. So I'm sure that was great for him to go through that. But I started thinking, episode 8's almost done here. Well,
yeah, this kind of stuck out to me as, wait a minute, something's not adding up, because they wrapped episode 8 a week early, And normally on a film, you don't loop your lines until deep, deep, deep into production, at least after the picture has been locked, which means they're done cutting. They won't do any more cutting because now comes the sound work. And that comes usually only a few months before the release. So he wouldn't really be looping his lines until
October or September.
Late next year.
Right. When they lock the picture.
So I'm sure he wasn't lying. Why would he lie? But I'm just wondering, because they don't know what they're going to have to reshoot. If they reshoot something, they'll need to bring him in again. So let's just get him in one time to do his ADR instead of having to come in, have him come in little by little.
It's possible, too, that his scenes probably could have been done months ago as well.
Right, but they won't necessarily do the looping until they've got the picture locked, just because that's when they know nothing else will be changed. So now we can do all the sound work.
That's a good point.
But you know what I'm excited about?
New catchphrases?
No, that this means that Luke will definitely speak in episode 8. That's what I got from that comment.
Yeah. I just have to make a quick little interjection. When Rian Johnson came into the panel for the future filmmakers and thing and confirming and being excited of being part of Star Wars doing something they've never done before was picking up exactly where the last movie left off. And I got really excited about that. I know some people are going to go, a lot of fans are going to go, well, that's not how it's been done before. But the way episode 7 ended, I'm like, yes, please. Mm-hmm. I need to know that conversation that he has with Rey right then. I don't want to hear about it a year later. I want to know what Rey says.
I'm totally with you. Totally.
Yeah. And so what? So what that it's never been done this way before? Let's move forward.
Yeah. Let's come in to episode 8 on a helicopter shot. Let's do that.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. And I know a lot of people are saying, well, what about the opening crawl? I think they could tell us what's going on with Leia and Chewie and Rey and Poe and Finn.
Yeah.
And then and BB-8.
Especially Finn. I mean, Finn was kind of left on a cliffhanger there.
Yeah. And now remember when we last left off with episode 7 and here's our story.
Yeah, it's like the comic books. The comic books do that.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think they've got this way planned out.
Yeah, yeah. I'm excited about the beginning of episode 8. I just can't wait.
I'm just curious about what these new catchphrases are going to be. I know Rian Johnson is an amazing writer, and I just can't imagine what he's come up with. That excites me.
Yeah.
All right, now let's move forward and move back at the same time to when Mark was talking about when he auditioned for Star Wars, he read, and it wasn't until months later that he got the phone call that he got the part of Luke. And when he got that phone call, he didn't remember who he auditioned for. He didn't even know that he was the lead. He thought Han Solo was the lead, since Harrison Ford was more of the leading man type.
I get the part, right? They call me up, and they said, oh, you got the part. I said, oh, great. I get to go to England. I get to meet Sir Alec Guinness. It's my first movie. I'm very excited. And they said, we'll send the script over. If I hadn't read the script, I couldn't even remember who I auditioned for. It had been a month and a half or something. And so I open up the script, and it says, The Adventures of Luke Skywalker, as taken from the Journal of the Wills. Saga number one, The Star Wars. I said, wait a minute. Was I Luke? No. I was, because, you know, Harrison, to me, was a leading man guy. You know, he was, I don't know how old he was, 35 or something. So I said, oh, I'm his sidekick. Plus, he was cool. I was the one, you know, being, no, take me here, you know. Stamping my feet, I want to go to Aqualite. And he was, hey, you know, whatever. So I thought he was the lead. Who wouldn't? That's a leading man. It's got to be about him. So I start reading this thing, and oh my gosh. I'm telling you, it was magical. You didn't have to have the special effects and the music and everything. The magic was in those words and that imagery. It was just fantastic. And I kept going back and saying, I can't be this Luke guy. It's his story. Or at least it's from his point of view. I thought I was going to play the sidekick to the lead guy. So I said, I can't remember. I called my agent. I said, who did I audition for again? Am I this? Who? They said, you're Luke. I said, oh, my gosh. I couldn't believe it. I get a floating car? Oh, wow. I get my own robot. I get two robots. I get this light up, I don't know, the sword, fire sword or something. It's wild, man. It's funnier than hell. It's really funny. I mean, that's another thing is when I did the screen test, I said, is this parody? Is it like a Mel Brooks movie or something? I mean, who talks like this?
That's hilarious.
Yeah. I had never heard that story before from his perspective, you know, thinking that he was going to be the sidekick, and then he's realizing that, no, the story revolves around you.
Yeah.
You know what? And I've got many actor friends who have said the same thing, that they just got the part for a role. They have no idea what they're talking about or what. Did I audition for this? When?
Right. Because I'm sure they go on
so many auditions a day.
Wow.
That this is just one of the many stops they'll make.
Goodness.
And the fact that he thought, well, you know what? I'm coming off of these shows like General Hospital and Eight is Enough, but now I get a floating car and these robots and a fire sword?
Yeah, that was awesome to hear in person. I was laughing hard when he said that, because I'm trying to put myself in his shoes and thinking, like, who did I audition for again?
Yeah. How old was Mark Hamill?
He was, I want to say, 22, 23 years old.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. You're right.
So he's a young pup.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And, of course, Carrie Fisher was like 19.
She was 19, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. But Mark Hamill here, he gets the lead in episode one, Journal of the Wills, The Adventures of Luke Starkiller Skywalker, of the Phantom Menace, and we're going to attack the clones. Wait a minute, is this going to fit on a marquee? No wonder he thought this was really Saturday morning matinee Pulp Fiction.
Yeah.
Too funny, but he also said that the magic was right there in the words. But then toward the end, he was saying, who talks like this?
Well, it reminds me of a question he had early on when he was trying to explain what he had auditioned for, what he got for. And I think it was either one of his siblings or something like that was saying, Star Wars, is that kind of like Star Trek? And he goes, yeah, it's exactly like Star Trek.
Yeah. Let me just simplify it. It's Star Trek with more lasers.
Yeah, that was... That was funny.
And it's funny that he mentioned the whole Skywalker, Starkiller thing, because I know they had changed his name right in the middle of production, and I knew he wasn't very happy about that, but I didn't know they had to reshoot that scene where he runs in to save the princess, and here he is describing the reshoot of that very scene.
And by the way, when I told you the story about the title page, it was The Adventures of Luke Starkiller as taken from the Journal of the Wills. And I remember when they said, I said, why are we shooting me rescuing the princess again? We already did that last week. And they said, well, they're changing your name. Because I remember I take off my helmet. She goes, aren't you a little short for a stormtrooper? I said, I'm Luke Starkiller. I'm here to rescue you. I love that line, too. It's like, didn't you get the memo? I mean, you're a princess. That's what we do. We rescue you. Look at you right there on the aisle. Stand up. Look at, there's a perfect Princess Leia. Oh, look at how lovely you are. Make a turn. There you go. Yeah. And they said, no, we're changing your name. And they could have just gone to the back of my head and I could have dubbed it later, but, you know, the most expensive low-budget movie, we actually went back and reshot a scene. And I said, okay, so what is my name? Because you know what it's like. You get used to a name. I'm Luke Starkiller. That's what I know. And they said, oh, we're going to be Luke Skywalker. I said, Luke Skywalker? It sounds like Luke Flyswatter. I hate that name. I hate that name. I want to be Luke Starkiller. I could use the macho. You know, it's got a little grit to it, but people didn't like the name with kill in it.
Yeah, I was more excited about him referencing the Journal of the Wills, because the Wills is supposed to be this kind of... Church of the Jedi, which is kind of referred to when you talk about Lor San Tekka in episode 7. And so I don't know if that's kind of a throwback to that, but this Journal of the Wills is kind of like this kind of church that follows the Jedi and kind of either believes in their ideology and also keeps track of it as well. And that, at least that's what I, if I remember correctly, and I was excited that he actually brought that up, because after listening to him and Carrie Fisher, there's things in the dialogue that they had to go over and over again in the script, and they still remember it word for word, even though it has changed in the final release of the films.
Yeah, yeah.
That clip has got to surface someday of Mark Hamill saying, "I'm Luke Starkiller, I'm here to rescue you."
Oh, man, I love the fact that he's like, "Please keep the name. I need some more macho." Yeah.
But I was going to the Tosche station to pick up some power converters.
And my name is Starkiller, so he can't make fun of me.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, I've so hoped that resurfaces, or that surfaces someday. I would love to see that. And he's right. Why not just shoot an extra shot over his shoulder and then redub it later on? It would have been so much easier, so much more cost-effective.
But it's such a classic moment.
I thought it was interesting. They said they didn't want to have the name Kill in it. And, it kind of set this ground thing where, you know, we went from Revenge of the Jedi to Return of the Jedi.
Well, and Starwalker doesn't really – or no, Star – yeah, Starwalker doesn't roll off the tongue very well.
Yeah. Starwalker.
Yeah, like Starkiller. So Starwalker or Starflyer.
Yeah, I can take Starkiller, but Starwalker, then it becomes too much of a Marvel comic on screen.
Well, look at it this perspective, guys. You could have been eventually called Starkiller through Neverland.
Starkilling through Neverland. Wow. No, that sounds bad.
That takes on a whole new meaning.
Yeah. Yikes.
Oh, man. There we go. New t-shirt for Skywalking Through Neverland.
I'm processing this right now.
I know. Star killing through Neverland. It doesn't quite work.
I'm so glad they brought it back and used it for The Force Awakens. Mm-hmm. When Adam Driver spoiled that moment at Comic-Con last year, when he told the audience about he being at Starkiller Base, and looks over at J.J. Abrams like, "Oh, was I not supposed to mention that?" And well, doesn't matter anymore.
Yeah, it's out there.
Oh, I got really excited by hearing that.
The name?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I just love when I hear old names referred to in the Clone Wars and Rebels, because there's a fantastic book I hope no one ever reads called The Star Wars Annotated Scripts, and they have all of the revisions and all these names they didn't use, because I was working on a screenplay once upon a time, and I pulled every name Lucas didn't use.
Oh, and now they're gradually coming out in Star Wars like, Rebels.
Oh, come on, I still want to use those names.
Yeah. I'm sorry, Bendu?
Bendu, yeah, Jedi Bendu.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's so many things that I hear in the Clone Wars, like, okay, I gotta cross that name off the list. Ashla. Can't use that name anymore.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. The Ashlas, Bogans. Mm-hmm. Ah, come on, guys. Give
me
a break here.
Dave Filoni has that annotated scripts, and he's using it.
Gotta go to Skywalker and take that book from his office. Now, Mark Hamill finishes up this panel, and I just love how he calls all the fans, not just fans, but their family.
But listen, you know, it sounds corny, but, you know, you guys have been there from the very start and supported us through thick and thin, through highs and lows, and I can't tell you how much that means to me. I never expected to be in anything that would be remembered, or at least remembered fondly. And, you know, I think of you guys more as like my extended support group. You know, you're like, you are more like family than fans. And we can't thank you enough. We hope you all enjoy. I tell you, I can't wait for Rogue One. That looks fantastic.
No, Mark, that doesn't sound corny. That sounds awesome.
Aw, he never fails to draw a tear to my eye whenever he mentions that. And lately it's been like every time we've seen him, you know, when he went to Star Wars Weekends and showed up there, and I watched his entire panel, like, oh, yeah, the fans are family.
Yeah, he's one of us. He's a big comic book, sci-fi, movie fan. like he always says, if I wasn't here, I'd be down there with you guys.
Yeah, that was when he was saying that, two things are going through my mind. I started getting little goosebumps feeling that family, because I was sitting with friends that I considered family. And it was really nice of him to acknowledge that and say that to the crowd, because, you know, as he makes more of these appearances and how excited people are to, you know, meet him in his autograph line or in his pictures. And you can tell he's enjoying this and having fun with it. And the other thing I was feeling too was I was right next to the line of people that were, you know, he was starting to wrap up the show, and I could hear the kind of grumble of the people that could not have time to ask him a question.
Yeah.
You know? But, you know, other than that, though, it was nice that he did acknowledge the fans in that way and acknowledge them as kind of an extended family.
Yeah, even during the dark times, we were all right there with him. And Sarah, you were, because that's when you were introduced to the Star Wars saga.
It's true. Oh, I'm getting goosebumps now.
Yay, me too.
Well, me too. And I'm so glad he kept the beard, too.
Yeah?
Which means that he's getting ready for some reshoots at some point.
Yeah. I noticed. I was thinking about that too. And you know what? Honestly, I think he really looks good with the beard. I like it. I'm getting used to it.
Yeah, it's less shaggy.
Maybe more filled in.
Maybe Ray brought him a pair of scissors and said, you know, let's just clean this up a little bit. Because in that one shot that we saw on StarWars.com a while ago, of Rian Johnson on that first day shooting the Luke and Rey scene. Luke did have his beard very trimmed. So maybe Rey did have a pair of scissors in there. Or used the lightsaber. And zzz.
Yeah, right.
Fantastic. So, Kevin, thank you very much for joining us and recapping the Mark Hamill panel. And we were so happy to see this and even more excited when we saw Kevin!
Yes.
Kevin's up there on the big Jumbotron!
In his Team Hoojibs shirt!
And he's wearing a Team Hoojibs shirt. He's the first one to ask a question.
We were literally eating our eggs and bacon at breakfast, and, you know, all of a sudden, there's your face, and we're like, ah! we nearly spit out our eggs.
What's funny, for the rest of Mark's interview, it was actually hard for me to pay attention at times because my phone started blowing up. I started getting these screen captures of me on video, and I'm like, oh my gosh, that was being filmed.
Oh, that's awesome.
Well, I'm glad you weren't thinking about that as you were asking the question.
No, I was not.
That's
If you did have time to think, what question would you have preferred to ask him?
You know, I wanted to know more about that filming on Skellig Michael. And if I had to ask him one other question, and it was something that if I did get his autograph again, I would have asked him about the origin of those funny autographs that he has been doing on people's cards. And if you've seen Facebook, you've seen these funny little references. And some of them are a little mature. Some of them are silly. But I kind of wanted to ask him why he started doing that and how that has now become a thing where he does funny autographs for people when they ask for it.
Well, I think after 40 years, you want to shake things up a little bit.
Yeah, and I swear I had a couple of items for him to sign in case I did get an autograph. I said, just go to town, do whatever you want.
Oh, yeah.
Now, is this the first time we've seen his dog, Millie?
For me, yes, because he and Carrie came out on the closing ceremonies or future filmmakers first and then closing ceremonies. That was the first time I remember seeing him. I'm thinking, like, since Gary's gotten a free ride around the world, I'm sure he's like, hey, can I bring my dog too?
Yeah, really? Well, didn't the dog – he first showed up at the end of Mark Hamill's panel. All of a sudden there was a dog running around, right?
Yeah.
Someone handed him – I think his daughter Chelsea – handed him the dog.
Is that what happened? Well, but he was like running around and you're like, wait, there's a dog here all of a sudden. And we weren't introduced to Millie yet.
I didn't see that.
Yeah.
Maybe that was Gary.
No. It was Millie.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Huh. I'll have to watch that again.
Yeah, it's interesting. Well, okay. So Kevin, before we wrap up, we want to know just a couple other questions. Now, you mentioned that you did not get any autographs, but did you get any pictures with celebrities?
Yeah, actually, I did in the not normal way when I did my Wilro Hood run, which is become a tradition now at Celebration. We kind of weave in and out of you know, the dealer hall, and sometimes we'll go through panels. And we ended up on the Star Wars show stage. Okay. Where we got to run around the stage and around the host from the Star Wars show that they're doing. But before, when we were staging to do that, Ray Park was right there.
Ooh.
And he recognized the Wilrow Hoods, and he took a selfie with us.
Yay!
With his own camera. And then we get cued on, and we go onto the stage, and we do the little Wilrow Hood thing, and we're waving in front of the camera. And I decided to pull out my camera, and I took a selfie with the Wilrow Hoods and the host, and they did that as well. But when I got off the stage, I went up to Ray. I said, Ray, can I take a selfie with you? And he said, yeah. And he ended up coming to the 501st party, where we had Steve Sansweet show up, so I got a picture with him. Matt Wood was there. You know, and so yeah, I was able to get pictures, but not it was fun because it was selfies and I didn't have to, like, you know, pay the $200 or whatever it is to do the professional ones. It was kind of just the opportunity presented itself, and I was able to get pictures that way.
Awesome. That's always the best, honestly.
Oh yeah, those personal pictures. And yeah, I it kind of aggravates me when celebrities go, no, I can't take a picture with you. I've got to go through my agent and through my publicist and through my lawyer and spiritual advisor.
I mean, well, it makes sense if they, because they get money that way. But.
Yeah, I understand that, but it's because of the fans that they are where they are then.
Well, it was nice. Ray Park was genuinely excited to see the Wilrow Hoods. He knew what we were about.
Nice. Where did you all end up running?
We started in the queue area for where the 501st and Rebel Legion, there's this big room they let us change, and we started there. And we try to hit strategic areas. We try to stop by panels. We try to stop by the art area. We try to go where there is cameras and also photo opportunities. And one thing that people don't realize, like, why do you do the Wilrow Hood thing, Kevin? We kind of get carte blanche to do stuff that other people don't get to do. And we were able to people, when people see us, they go, oh, let's stop everything. Let the Wilrow Hoods run through. And there's a lot of spontaneous photo opportunities that we get to do. When we see someone, you know, getting next to a Kylo Ren awesome cosplay, we'll run around them, and it presents another awesome photo opportunity. And we got to get on the stage live streaming across the world with that. And so it's a really fun thing to be a part of. I love my Wilrow Hood brothers.
You guys are like a twister of cosplayers.
Yes, that's a good way to put it, actually.
Now, did you have an ice cream social this time as well?
We did not have an ice cream social this time. If we had a four-day convention, we might have.
Right.
But because there was so much going on each night, we kind of decided, let's just go to – a lot of us went to the 501st Rebel Legion party that's always on the Saturday night. But we did surround this guy that was eating some ice cream, and we started yelling, one of us, one of us.
That's awesome.
That is awesome. What other kind of cosplayers did you see there that really stuck out to you?
Oh gosh, there was a guy that had a great General Grievous. This one girl was dressed up as was it Batine?
Right.
I'm trying to remember the name. The assassin girl that snitched on
BB-8.
Yeah. That was sitting next to Grumgar.
In the black this and girl, white.
Yeah. She had this great costume going on there. And there's the kids dressing up was one of the highlights, because parents were really just being great parents and letting their kids have fun and dress up. And that was one of the highlights as well. But we saw a lot of great costumes,
awesome.
a lot of EU costumes as well. But this guy
was there any Thrawn?
I did see Thrawn. Yes, we actually had one for our big photo shoot for Rebel Legion and 501st. But the costume contest was won by a guy as Grumgar, that big guy that you see Batine next to, that big kind of guy that is grumbling that she's sitting on his lap, and the costume was just fantastic.
Yeah, we saw that on the live stream.
Yeah,
and it just looked phenomenal.
Or his handler got interviewed because he couldn't speak.
Yes.
Yeah. At every convention, the cosplayers just kick it up to the next level.
It's so much fun.
That's the part I always look forward to at every convention, is just to see the mashups. Like, my favorite was the Star Wars Planet of the Apes mashup, X-Wing pilots and TIE pilots. And
I saw that. I immediately thought of you, Richard.
There's Darth Zeus right there. Oh, it just blew my mind. And
what, one of my favorites that I saw was I made friends with these guys in the German 501st Garrison, and two of the guys dressed up as Imperial officers, but with Waldorf and Statler from the Muppet Heads.
Whoa.
Yeah, I love those kind of mashups.
Yeah, me too. Well, Jedi Tink. Oh, we love mashups over here.
Yay! Now, Kevin, tell everyone where they can find you on social media and the Fandom Podcast Network.
Yeah, I am the co-host and co-founder of the Fandom Podcast Network with my good friend Kyle and Norman Lau. You can find us on Facebook at Fandom Podcast Network, but please find all of our shows on Fandom Podcast Network under iTunes, Stitcher, Podbean, and also Google Play. We've got some great shows on there. We've got a weekly culture clash show where we talk about everything nerdy and geeky. My buddy Norman and I are big Highlander fans. We have a dedicated Highlander show called Blood of Kings. We have a monthly show called Fandom Flashback where we look back on a favorite property, whether it's a movie series, cartoon series. We've covered G.I. Joe, Highlander. Right now we're doing Robotech. And we've just started a brand new show called Couch Potato Theater. Well, once a month we pick a kind of cult classic movie that we all know and love and that we want to kind of revisit. And maybe it didn't get the love that it did in the theater, but it found life again on maybe VHS or whatever it is. And so we're really excited about that. And find us on Fandom Podcast Network. You can find me on Twitter at Spartan_Phoenix. And we got a really good group of people on the Fandom Podcast Network right now. And we're really, really excited about it.
You know what? That just proves that once you start podcasting, you never go back. It's a slippery slope.
I have you guys to thank for that. You guys are very inspirational, and I throw little shout outs to you guys from time to time, because when it comes to production and entertainment and value, I look at you guys first, and I thank you guys for it.
Aww.
Where do you go from there?
I know. Well, thank you, Kevin. Hashtag Team Hoojib for life.
Yes, hashtag Team Hoojib.
And thank you so much for being on.
Shout outs, Skywalker, shout outs. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shout out. Who was photoballed? Shout out. Who was shared a post? Shout out.
First and foremost, we want to say thank you to all of our Skywalkers who attended San Diego Comic-Con and kept everyone in the know with photos, tweets, and Facebook posts. So Brian Sims, Kai Charles, and Margaret Mays, you are our heroes. Looks like you guys had an awesome time, and I know this week we're talking to Kai, so super exciting to hear her firsthand accounts. All right, this next shout out, Richard, I want you to read, because this was a Facebook post in our Facebook group by Bill Medea. So he posted this picture.
Okay, he writes, while reading the latest issue of Famous Monsters of Filmland, now let's stop right there. This was a magazine I thought went out of print 20 years ago.
Wow.
This was the book you read as a kid when you loved monsters. But they were a very smart publisher. Well, what a tangent here. That they would reprint all of their articles every 5 years because their age bracket would grow out of monsters. So they would just keep reprinting stuff.
Oh, my goodness.
But I didn't know that was still in print.
Wow.
All right. Now, back to Bill Medea. I saw this available from the Warner's archive. My favorite episode. Now, what he's talking about here, what he's looking at, is a panel from Secret Squirrel.
The Secret Squirrel Show, the complete series, now on DVD. Wow.
My favorite episode was the one where he tried to stop a pair of renegade podcasters. Oh, wait, that was real life.
Nice.
So while flipping through Famous Monsters, he looks over and there's Secret Squirrel on DVD.
Yeah. And he thought of us. So we thought that was so cool.
I don't think anyone's mentioned Secret Squirrel in the last 30 years.
I know.
Before our incident.
Now, was this like a 60s show? Or
60s, 70s.
Somewhere in there? Okay.
I remember watching it as a kid and going, wow, that's a funny name, Secret Squirrel. I gotta archive that and use it. when they try to stop us at Disneyland from podcasting and advertising their property.
Right.
You're welcome, Disney.
One John Jedi says 70s.
70s.
So anyway, we love how people take things born in our show and kind of run with them, or, you know, they're in everyday life and all of a sudden something makes them think of skywalking. So
we'll get pictures so of cool. random squirrels.
Yes.
People will just send us.
Well, and even Brian Sims posted in our Facebook group a picture of Jackson in real life.
Yeah, wasn't it a kangaroo, though?
Well, what? Well, I think, are you still on, Brian Sims? What was that?
Yeah, he posted a picture of a kangaroo, but like had the long Jackson ears and looked like it could be Jackson.
That was so cute.
Which was really, really funny.
It was like, okay, a kangaroo.
So keep those bunny, kangaroo, and squirrel pictures coming.
Yes. We love our rodents, apparently.
just not rats. We don't like rats.
No.
Okay, moving right along.
Moving to our final shout out of the week. The Star Wars landline is in full force. So at Disney Dad Blog, he tweeted a picture of himself and his two sons by that Big Thunder Mountain Trail at Disneyland, that sign. And he tweeted, first in line for Star Wars Land. Hashtag Star Wars Landline. I figured Jedi Tink and Sith Rich would be here waiting too.
Yeah, we were, but Secret Squirrel came and said we couldn't stand there for more than 6 weeks.
Oh.
So we had to leave. We took a stroller around the park, and I think that's when you were coming to the line, and we were on the other side, so we just missed you by a couple seconds.
Yes, but thanks so much for tweeting, and whenever you happen to be at Disneyland, just post pictures of yourself right there. Hashtag Star Wars Landline.
And tell Secret Squirrel to mind his own business.
All right, that brings us to the Skywalker of the Week.
Star Wars Celebration, warm-up comedian, it's Star Wars Weekend, warm-up comedian, Mark Daniel.
Congratulations, Mark Daniel.
Hey, thanks, Mark, for showing our Skywalking Through Neverland button on your Celebration Europe wrap-up. That was a great Easter egg, and we appreciate that.
Absolutely. And thanks to Rob Dellinger for composing your very own special jingle.
And as you all know, he is
the John Williams of podcasting. And now, it's time for a Skywalker story.
Skywalker story. Sharing those Skywalker stories with Richard and Sarah. Skywalker stories.
Wherever your fandom lies, chances are you have a story to tell.
In our continuing Skywalker story series, we will hear from Rune Marchant.
Hey, Rune!
Hey, you too.
So, Rune, it sounds like you have a great Skywalker story that works on many Skywalker levels.
I would like to think so, yes.
Let's see. Well, we heard that you were at Star Wars Celebration Orlando. Is that right?
Yes, it's Star Wars Celebration Orlando 2. That's where it takes place, yes.
Tell us who you met there and what kind of ordeal you went through.
I met Mark Hamill on the first day he was there. So I went to his line first thing so I could get his autograph first off, because, you know, he'll have a long line. And I was like the 12th person in line. After a long wait, because people want to wait and talk. Then when I got to him, I handed the guy, his assistant, the movie, like, hey, that's cool. Then when the person in front of me got down with him, he just didn't hand into the DVD and Mark.
Wait, so what movie are you handing him?
Comic Book the Movie.
Ah.
All right,
this was
his directorial debut.
Oh.
Yes.
Yeah. So Mark Hamill actually directed this movie?
He directed it and wrote it and starred in it, and it was a pretty fun Comic-Con-based movie.
Oh,
From like the mid to late 90s.
Yes.
But and you had a copy of it that you wanted him to sign.
Yes.
Okay, so his assistant grabbed it and said, wow, this is cool?
Yeah, something similar to that, because I don't know the exact words, but something like that, yes.
Okay.
All right, then when he handed it to Mark, how did Mark respond?
Like, so you're the one who bought the movie. Yeah. And he noticed that I had it signed by Billy West. He is a voice actor who starred in the movie as the grandson of the guy of the comic the movie is about.
Right.
Oh, wow.
and his other assistant took a picture of it. He got a laugh out of it.
Wait, so what did Billy West sign on there?
Okay, he said, "Billy West, the real reason to see this movie."
Ah, from Billy West, the real reason to see this movie?
Yes, because apparently he's a star, but he wasn't on the cover.
Oh.
Yeah, so he wrote that down, and that's how Mark got his chuckle for the day.
And then Mark Hamill tweeted this out, and how far did the tweets go?
We tweeted almost 100 times and liked about the same amount of times.
Oh, that's awesome. So what I like about your story is that you had written to us that Mark turned to his other assistant and said, "Hey, let's tweet this." And I think that's awesome. That must be how Mark tweets. He doesn't tweet himself. Yeah. He just tells his assistant.
Yeah. It's always good to give the celebrity something rare or something off the beaten track to give them the sign.
Right.
Because if you give them the same old posters, they're going to just sign it and move along. But you give them something that probably he doesn't see, but once a year or once every couple of years.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think if you and I showed up both with our comic book, the movie DVDs, it's like, oh, okay, we knew we sold two, and there they are.
Yep.
Now, I take it, Ruin, that you've seen comic book, the movie. What did you think of it?
I thought it was pretty great.
It was a fun romp.
Okay.
All right, good deal. Well, I'm glad you had something like this, something as rare as comic book, the movie, to give to him, because it obviously made an impact.
Yeah, because not every day you'll be treated by one of your favorite stars.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I've got a copy of The Night the Lights Went Out in Georgia sitting right here. I can't wait for him to sign that.
Yeah.
No one has asked him to sign a copy of that.
Well, hopefully he'll be there next year.
Yeah?
Yeah, oh, he definitely will be. He definitely will be. He's a staple at all these Star Wars Celebration conventions.
Yeah.
All right, well, to wrap things up, if you ever meet Carrie Fisher, what would you give to her to sign?
I have a still from the holiday special.
You're looking to make friends with her, huh?
Yes.
I think she would give that still to Gary.
Well, I'm sure she will. Yeah, he can sign it for her.
And then she'll throw glitter on you.
Yeah. So that'd be even better.
You know what? I would do that to get a glitter
Absolutely.
Bomb from Carrie Fisher.
Yeah.
Yes.
Awesome. Awesome. All right, Rune. Well, thank you very much for sharing your story. And once again, it's always good to hear from a fan who got something autographed and made the star chuckle or laugh or made their day.
Or tweet.
Yep. Or all of you above.
All right. Well, thank you, Rune. And where can people find you if they want to get in touch with you?
Well, I'm on Facebook and on Twitter.
Great. And what is your Twitter handle?
At One True Rune.
Ah, nice. And is that R-O-O-N?
Yes. All one word.
Awesome.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Rune. And remember,
never land on Alderaan.
And if you do, bring comic book the movie.
I'm sure. Of course.
Skywalking through Neverland.
Our convention coverage continues, this time with San Diego Comic-Con, which just happened last weekend. And like Star Wars Celebration Europe, we were not able to go. But luckily, the Skywalkers were out in full force.
Kai Charles is back once again to tell us all about her adventures in San Diego.
Hey Kai!
Hello, hey, I have raspy, sexy voice.
Well, we love it.
Did you do that just for us?
No, it's too much air conditioning, alcohol, and lack of sleep. That's the combination.
Is that due to Comic-Con?
That is this year's Comic-Con. You know, I was trying to think of how to tell you guys. It's, you know, from Forrest Gump, how he says life is like a box of chocolates.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
That's what Comic-Con is like. Every year, it's different, and you can plan and plan, but you actually have to go with what fate makes that year be, and you just have to go with it.
Okay. So what happened this year?
That involved a lot of alcohol.
Well, this year was more like the social. I volunteered, which was pretty fascinating and amazing. And then also it was more about socializing, lots of shopping, and lots of books. So most people, you know, Comic-Con is just this whole umbrella of everything, which is why it's so crowded. And one of the things that if you're a reader, pretty much every big major publisher is there, and you just walk down the aisles and they give you free books. And so I'm looking at about 50 of them that replaced all the clothes that used to be in my weekend bag.
Oh my goodness.
You know what? Before we started recording, you were telling us something that Random House was doing.
Oh yes. So their booth had an audio booth, and you could go and take, they had a Game of Thrones trivia. And if you took the Game of Thrones trivia, you got these free earbuds, and then you scheduled a massage appointment. And then you go back, and it was a chair massage, and you put your face down, you get a massage, and you get to listen to an audiobook. And so you get like a 10 free minute massage.
That is awesome. How long was the line for that?
No, this is the weird thing. No one. I went and took the, I was just walking by, and you know, one of the things that helps these, this publisher's booth be there for you is if you participate in what they're doing. And they scan your badge, and that gets them access to your email, which means they then can email you newsletters and special coupons. And so so she did her job really well.
And that's great that they have that setup where they just scan your badge.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very helpful. And now with the RFID badges, I think it's going to, it helps them control it, how many people are in the convention center at one time, which helps with the fire marshal.
Now, did it seem less crowded, or was it just as crowded as ever?
No, I heard that there were actually more tickets sold this year, and I believe it. But it was, they did a big expansion next to the convention center as a big hotel. I think it's called the Marriott Marina Marquis.
Right.
And completing that, I swear that changed the face of Comic-Con. Everything they did over there, that's where the volunteers met. That's where you picked up redemption items. That's like if you're in a panel and they give you a ticket for a freebie. In the upper levels, you could just go and sit there like no one was there.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Now, apart from the air conditioning and the alcohol, what else really excited you this year about San Diego Comic-Con?
I think, you know, it's funny because I expected very little of Star Wars because coming off Celebration.
Right.
But Star Wars is living well and strong at Comic-Con. I mean, their whole area, basically there's booth in area 2913 is basically like the Star Wars wing. So they put all of the Star Wars related booths there, which makes it very easy for shopping. So Hallmark is there. DK Books is there. Loungefly is on the other side. All of these different places, HerUniverse. And so just hanging out there, that was the Star Wars area. And it was packed every single day. Also, they had the outfits from Rogue One. I don't know if it was the same ones at Celebration, but they were about, there was Cassian's kind of Han Solo inspired one.
Right.
Krennic's outfit and Rey. And each of them had like the name of the characters. It looked like the exact display. The funniest thing though was because of the air conditioner, all weekend Krennic's robes were like flowing.
Whoa.
So cool, because you would walk by and he's flanked by two, I think they were Death Troopers.
Yeah.
And his robe was just blowing in the air conditioning. And it was hilarious.
Oh, that's perfect. Did they have any props or just the costumes?
They had no props, just the costumes, but Lego went all out. They made an amazing Death Trooper made out of Legos. That was, the detail on it is amazing considering the bricks were all black. It had an amazing detail on it. One of the things I really freaked out about this year was like the Hasbro panel. And one of the things they released that was coming out was the, I'm going to say AT-AT, but we all know that Rogue One AT-AT has those extra letters in between it.
Yeah, the AT-ACT.
Oh. Is that what it
yes.
is?
Okay. Yes. So they not only they reveal that in the Hasbro panel, they went all out in this display, and I filmed it. It's on my Twitter feed. They basically recreated the battle that we haven't even really seen yet. They basically created the ocean battle. So they made this. They had the sand and a little lake, and these AT-ATs actually walk. And so they were walking, and then they had, and they make sounds. So you hear the laser sounds, you hear, and they shoot foam, like
Nerf darts.
And it was fascinating because I was wondering if there was a little bit of a spoiler because, and the sides of the AT.
ACT.
Why don't you say AT-ACT? Ad act.
They weren't calling that one an ad act. They were talking about when they were kids, how they one of the toys they always wanted was the ad act, and they didn't get it. And I was like, that's my childhood. Uh-huh. And so they said when the opportunity came, they knew they were going to make the ATSCT. And so, but they call it ad. They were still talking ad at this and ad at that.
Okay.
But when, yeah, the top of it opens up, and inside there are three figures. There is a astromech droid, a stormtrooper, and Jen Erso.
Oh.
And I'm wondering, like, does Jen Steele and AT, why is she in that playset?
Yeah.
Like, and so it was, but Star Wars was very dominating there, and including once again, Hasbro underestimated the power of Star Wars, and Jen Erso sold out in, I think, 2 days.
In the Black Figure series?
We had no tickets for Saturday. So if you were there Thursday and Friday and you were lucky enough to get a ticket, you got Jen Erso. Saturday, they were completely out of so much stuff that they didn't even pass out tickets.
Wow. You know what? I'm thinking they might have added Jen Erso to the AT-AT playset or AT-ACT playset because they didn't have Rey in the Millennium Falcon playset.
Yeah, that would be interesting. It was.
But Rey belongs in the Millennium Falcon.
I know. That's
exactly
what I'm saying.
All right. Did Hasbro offer an exclusive 3¾-inch action figure like they normally do?
No, what they did was they gave us Kylo Ren, of course, the same one from, I think it was the same one from Celebration. Mm-hmm. And then there was the Obi-Wan one that him looking at the hologram of Leia, and which looked really detailed. But
and these are all the Black Series, right?
No, it's not Black Series. They only had one Black Series. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
The only Black Series they had was Jen Erso. And I met a friend of mine, my comic book shop owner, and I was going to go for it. And he said, you know, I really wouldn't waste your time because basically there was nothing special about it. This is the same exact Black Series that we'll all be able to buy in a few months. At least last year with the first order trooper, it came with a special booklet, and they had special markings on the side of the box.
Right, but as you recall, there was such turmoil over getting those figures that people were hurting each other. So
yeah.
I think it's very smart of them to not go that direction. It's like, okay, this is what you're going to get. You'll get the same thing in Toys R Us in September because we don't want anyone mauling at each other over a toy.
Yeah.
Instead, they had people cursing them out on social media because The deal with Comic-Con is, and this happened with me with Loungefly, I was very disappointed. The thing with Comic-Con is they believe in fairness. And if you have exclusives, technically, you are supposed to give opportunity to across the 4 days. So somehow Hasbro dropped the ball. Either last year it happened, they said that they were missing some of their shipment. So that Thursday went fine. Friday, I got a ticket. Friday at 2:00, I got to the Hasbro booth. They had no first order troopers, but they were like, come back tomorrow. Well, we're getting our order. And I said, well, will I have to get in line? And they're like, no, just come to the booth Saturday morning. You're a Friday ticket holder. You're going to get priority. Saturday morning, I went to the booth. I was yelled at and told to go stand at the wall. And so by the time, and 20 minutes later, after standing at the wall, no first order troopers.
Wow.
So at least this year, I guess whatever screw up they had, they corrected the mistake of not passing out tickets on Saturday. So I don't know what's up with Hasbro. I have to be careful what I say about them because I have a big chip on my shoulder in regards to them. But I think I was very pleased with the panel this year. I think they're finally getting it about the female figures. There's some really great stuff coming.
There's a bunch of people on Twitter have beat it into their heads.
I think so. The problem now we have is getting them in the stores, but I decided this year I'm just going online. I don't need the stress.
Right.
So I'm ordering everything online. But the displays were amazing. Lots of figures. There's some new Rays coming. She was prominently.
Lots of Rays coming. She only has two outfits.
Well, they're releasing they're releasing more. So they made sure in their display they showed Rey with the lightsaber and it was saying on the card. Just basically, I think they're reinforcing that they're going to get these in the store. She was actually everywhere in all of the displays. So I think they understand the popularity, but they just can't seem to get the follow through.
Right.
You know, I mean, there were hundreds of little girls dressed like Rays, and the Star Wars Pavilion, they would lose their mind every time they see a little Ray, and they call them over and they take pictures of them and they give them little gifts. The ABC, the C-3PO book that you guys.
Yes.
ABC-3PO?
Yes. Well, they had. So Thursday, after hearing the show on I was like, okay, I need to buy that. And I waited because they were giving a free little figure, a free little stuffed little thing with it. Oh. And so I thought this, yeah, you either got Kylo or Rey, or I can't remember. I think there was a little Finn. So Thursday I made it into the Hasbro line and I'm looking at the book there and the little, and they were giving out Rey that day. And I was like, oh, okay, I have to get over there. But I was focused on getting the Boba Fett. So I got the Star Wars stuff I wanted from Hallmark for the first time in like 4 years.
Ooh, yeah.
And so after that, I just got distracted because then they had Chuck Wendig there signing Aftermath. So I had to get that. And then they were giving away BB-8 Spiro posters. They basically posed a BB-8 in a glam shot in front of the convention center. So they were giving away these amazing posters of that. The Star Wars area was just... it was just a madhouse. It was really great. And then...
now, did Hasbro announce their fan pick action figure at San Diego Comic-Con?
I think they did. Let me recycle in my brain.
Oh, please say Jackson. Please say
they
Jackson.
They did, but it wasn't Jackson.
No, it wasn't Jackson.
It was
female Jackson.
No, it was...
I know they're making a Hera, but I can't remember if Hera was...
No, it's the character that Trisha really loves.
Poe Dameron.
From...
Jaina Solo was she, Jaina and Solo. It was so funny because I tweeted to basically they run the contest into pretty much 30 minutes before the panel starts.
Wow.
The guy was like, I was just at the booth and 15 minutes ago, and it was funny because he said, yeah, and like in the past 24 hours her vote surged, I think. Basically he said like 40,000 or something, and he said, I really hope whoever posted those 40,000 votes buys a lot of Jaina Solo figures. And so I tweeted, I said, I don't know, I wonder if that was Fangirl Cantina.
Yep.
and she was laughing, but yeah, it was great to see her win. She's such a powerful EU character. I cannot remember who. No, she won. There was no backup figure this year.
Oh.
I don't think so. There might have been. Oh, and they announced a lot of the Black Series that are coming. So the Imperial Guard, Hera is getting... I don't think Hera's is Black Series, though, because Hera's actually getting a two-pack where they're doing a figure with a ship.
Okay. But I did see a Black Series of Hera and of Sabine. Like,
yeah,
pictures.
So I think they're doing, do they call them the 3.75 Black Series?
Oh, yeah, I don't know. I just saw pictures.
Three and three quarters?
Yes, 3 3/4. So they're doing Hera, but I think they're also doing another set because they were showing Hera with an A-Wing.
Oh.
And they were explaining how they took the actual and details from the Rebels episode. Mm-hmm. For the...
season three?
For the decoration of the A-Wing. They actually worked with Dave Filoni to find out the best way to translate her from animation to human to make a Black Series. Mm. So they do a lot of research. And I have to say, I think the only problem I have with Hasbro is whatever department is responsible for getting them in the stores, because that seems to be where the ball is being dropped. But they showed an amazing video that shows what goes into making a Black Series. And they actually use over 40 different pieces. They computer generate like a lot of scans and show the different points of articulation. So, but the big, big reveal of the Hasbro panel was the AT, and everyone just lost their minds. It was, and also this AT is going to be, you can play with it just as a toy. Uh-huh. Like they really bridge the gap between child and collector, because if you just have a 12-year-old, you can buy them this toy. It walks. It makes sounds. Like they said, every mother's nightmare.
and you can run it by your phone.
Yes.
What?
And then then you can also activate different features by your phone.
Whoa.
And so, and it's amazing. So in the display, they kind of found a way to lock the legs so that it wasn't moving forward, but you got to see how the legs moved. And so basically their display was showing, and they put all of these stormtroopers, and they put, like, it was like they recreated a battle inside this glass display case. And they had the Star Wars music running and the special effects sound. It was like they were very proud and happy with it. They were like, everyone go down to the booth and go check it out.
Wow.
So they're doing lots of the smaller size Black Series.
Let's take a break from our chat with Kai Charles to hear a sneak peek from next week's episode.
Across the sea of stars lies another world, a world almost exactly like ours. This is where he lives. He's 27 years old, single but searching. Favorite sports, windsurfing and Aikido. Favorite pastimes, cigars and sex. He has everything except fulfillment. And then one night, it happens.
Hey, good buddy, are you home?
He has a very sudden midlife crisis. He lands in Cleveland.
You do know why you were sent to me?
Listen to me, small visitor. I can explain how you got here.
Maybe you're here for some greater purpose, some cosmic cause.
Here, he's forced to reassess his career goals.
You went to med school?
To explore new relationships. To redefine his self-image.
I'm sorry, we don't allow pets on the premises.
To adjust to a changing lifestyle.
All right, pull it off!
Until he discovers just who he really is.
Oh, no.
A duck in big trouble.
That's a duck, man!
Howard the Duck, trapped in a world he never made. Coming from George Lucas, a Willard Hike film, a Gloria Katz production.
And now back with Kai Charles and her San Diego Comic-Con highlights. So now let's jump over to Star Wars publishing.
Okay.
What did we learn new about that?
Okay, so it's interesting, just to backtrack a little, the Star Wars panels every year, like Friday is Star Wars Day, I just walk into the Star Wars room. And so the very first panel they had was called The Science of Star Wars, and the fellow Skywalkers, Brian and Margaret, went in, and I was running up there, and I couldn't get into the room.
Oh.
So I basically stood outside for 40 minutes, and the line was wrapping around the back of the building. And so thankfully, I got into the publishing panel. And I have to say, I've never been offended by old canon versus new canon. But this panel, they really expressed why this is important, what they're doing, and what Disney's goals are. Disney wants world domination with Star Wars. Like they want you cradle to the grave. That this is what they want. And so it was really fascinating. The publishing panel, so many authors were there, and I couldn't, like, I was so excited by the information coming, and their names weren't in the book. The author of Mike Kogi was there, who's been on your show.
Oh, yeah. Skywalker.
Yeah. Chuck Wendig was there. Katie Cook.
The illustrator for ABC 3PO.
Yes. The writer of the Art of Star Wars book was there. The artist, there's artists and colorists. The artist of the Han Solo comic was there. Mm. So many people. And so the moderator of the panel, who's a Disney publishing employee, it's fascinating because he basically was saying that one of the missions that they want to do is going forward is there's a lot of new people coming to Star Wars, and they want to have a clear-cut pattern to show them where to start. And so that is where the genesis of basically ABC 3PO is, basically for you to get the younger kids and also for the collectors. And also to those middle grade novels that came out December 18th were very popular for them. That would be Moving Target, the Han Solo one, the Princess Leia one, and the Luke Skywalker one, which Weapon of a Jedi, I think it was.
Right.
So those were very successful. But like the moderator said, those are middle grade books. So those don't really fit the demographic between ABC, 3PO and middle grade.
Right.
So they are actually going to revamp those three books into a lower chapter book format. And they're going to change the titles a little. So Weapon of a Jedi will be retold in the form of Luke and the Lost Temple.
Huh.
And they're making these as chapter books. So they're basically trying to graduate your little Padawans from 5-6 to middle grade, and then they're going forward with the adult books. And I found that really fascinating, and I thought that's really smart of them to do that. They're really cognizant of the fact that The Force Awakens brought a lot of new people to Star Wars, brought a lot of people who haven't done anything with Star Wars for, let's say, 15, 20 years. And maybe now they're hungry for something. Maybe they're like, well, what is this Aftermath thing all about? It's been on the New York Times bestselling list for, you know, 15 weeks. Should I read that? What does that take place? You know, I didn't finish Aftermath. Thankfully, they were giving away a free copy at Comic-Con, so I took it to try again. But Chuck Wendig was saying that the second one, Life Debt, is a little bit more streamlined. So I think that was his way of kind of acknowledging that he knew people had a problem with it. Like, I don't.
Wow.
You know,
and he doesn't do that.
Yeah, I feel like Chuck Wendig does not need to change his writing style, but I feel that I think it was a mistake that Aftermath was released first. I think Shattered Empire was amazing because basically what fans wanted, we wanted to know what happened right after Return of the Jedi. We wanted to see the morning after, the drunk Ewoks, you know, we wanted to know what happened from that day on.
Right.
And Aftermath didn't give us that. Aftermath gave us what happened basically a few years before Bloodline. And so we're all, and a lot of people don't read comics. So, and by the time Shattered Empire was collected and on the shelves where people would see it at their local Barnes and Noble, they had already ran and bought Aftermath.
Right.
And then they thought, oh, this new canon sucks. So I think in a way he said this book is more a little bit more streamlined. It's basically, of course, obviously about Han and Chewie, just by the title alone. And I won't spoil. Yeah, he was really cool. He was having a good time. I think hundreds of people were in his line for Aftermath every day. And it couldn't have been just because it was free, because they had them just laying there in the afternoon for free. So. A lot of people, there are definitely a lot of fans of the book and people who are interested in it after the publishing panel. And then Katie came on and she, you know, they announced her as the author of the most adorable, you know, Star Wars book. And she talked a little bit. She's so sweet. If you guys don't follow her on Twitter, she's so much fun. If you're ever at a con, you have to go see her because she makes these little tiny art drawings.
Yeah.
And she'll do, like, for $10, she'll do a portrait of your cat or your pet, or she draws hundreds of these. So my favorite of hers, I have a little one with a little Jawa, and above it it says Martini. And he's holding a little martini. She's really funny. So she was hilarious because she was talking about how she's been seeing people reading the book everywhere and it's killing her inside not to say. She's like, yeah, we were at the park and his mom was reading it to her son, and I was just waiting for her to mess up so I could step in and say, well, actually, that's actually a sand crawl. That, you know, like, and she's like, but everyone knows they're Star Wars. And that was Richard, was it you that I had listened to a podcast where someone was joking about there should be an OB-123? I thought that was you, Richard. Do you remember if you...
Sounds like something you'd say.
Yeah, so I'll take full credit for it.
I swear, I think it was you. You were like, "Oh, they should do OB-123," and so, and they say we've got a special little news for you. And up, they showed us the cover of the next book, and it's OB-123.
Whoa!
And I'm thinking, I'm like, someone called that, and I don't know who it was, and I think it had to be you because it must. I think you said it when you had Jocasta Drew on,
right?
I think I remember you saying that, and it looks adorable. Katie Cook is drawn. She's drawn. Old Ben is on the cover, but a cutified Katie Cook version of Old Ben.
Right.
And they were happy with the success of it. And I don't know if there's going to be more after OB-123, but they revealed that. They also revealed they did a lot of revelations, and I didn't take. Let's see. So, and of course that it was revealed at Celebration, but they talked a bit about Thrawn coming out. Mm.
Nice.
But just basically, they showed us some of the illustrations and art for Han Solo issue 2, which looks gorgeous. And that comic is doing very well. And they're going to continue with the 5-arc miniseries, just kind of rotating those.
The one thing I'm really looking forward to from Disney Lucasfilm Publishing is the new Ahsoka novel. Now, speaking of Ahsoka, did you go to the HerUniverse fashion show?
I did. Yeah, so I was working with another outlet, and so I contacted them and did press. And so I had a little closer seats this year.
Nice.
The same. They and she gave us an amazing goodie bag that I was just losing my mind over. So every year, like, it gets better and better. The first year it was like, oh, look, a little Darth Vader, itty bitty. Yes. And this year she gave us BB-8 socks, a little Hulk itty bitty. We got a Rey card, a greeting card that has Rey on the cover. And it says, the front of it says, you have just what it takes. And inside it says, to be awesome, make this year all yours. So I guess it's meant to be a birthday card. We got a set of espionage nails. I just can't remember a bunch of coupons and all of that in it. But it was amazing because there's an app called Comic-Con HQ that partnered with Ashley. So basically they've been filming behind the scenes of HerUniverse. And so I have been watching that show on the app. And I have to say, it really adds a different element to her fashion show. I feel like you get to see the process, how hard it is to pick they get hundreds and hundreds of candidates. And it's fascinating because this year there wasn't one Star Wars themed dress. Harry Potter was very dominant.
Wow.
It was very dominant. And so it was just kind of funny because they even showed the meeting on the meeting where the one girl is saying, like, I think we have too much Harry Potter. And now she's like, no, it's fine. It's so funny to see those little shows because, you know, she's a little dynamo, but it's wonderful that she has the power that this is her company, you know, and she has a great panel of people that work with her. So watching that leading up to the show really added an element. And each year her show gets better. But I have to say it's very interesting because some of the things that come down the runway, they're kind of a miss. And you kind of like will grimace a little and say, ooh, what happened there? But I think it's fabulous that there's an opportunity for people to do that. Like that this is truly, you basically can submit something to HerUniverse. And if she relates to your passion and she feels you can do it, she will go on that journey with you. Sometimes the journey is successful. There's never a bad outfit in her fashion show, but it's like, it's not so much just a fashion show. It's basically she builds up the confidence and trust of these designers. And like you learn in the show, even if you don't win, opportunities open from this show that are beyond belief. Last year, there was a woman, I think she did a female version of Back to the Future. Mm-hmm. And I don't think she won. But a designer who saw that outfit actually called her and they hired her to do something. So but the showstopper of this year was Ashley. And I give her so much credit. This did not leak at all. So before the show, before Ashley comes out, we're watching this video because I'm wondering, she always makes 3 or 4 costume changes. And I was wondering, what's Ashley going to do this year? Yeah. You know, so they show us this video. And it's her going to the first year winner, fan choice winner, whose first name's Andrew. I can't remember his last name. And she's in a Lego factory with him. And she decides that she wants to wear a high couture dress made of Lego. And they're looking at her and she wants to celebrate Ahsoka. And so she got permission from Dave to use one of the very first illustrations he drew of Ahsoka.
Wow.
Of her profile. And she said, I want this on a dress. And they kind of looked at her and they were like, okay. And it was a great behind the scenes on how Lego itself works, because the head designer that worked with her, you learn a little about his story. He was actually an accountant. Or he was either accountant or a CEO of a company, and he had a passion for Lego. And on his off time, he would design these elaborate Legos. And one day he got this opportunity and he took the jump and he left his day job. And now he works full time creating Lego masterpieces.
Right on.
Yeah. So basically they designed this kind of fabric skin that they could attach the Lego. So basically they, of course, had to take her measurements, mm-hmm. and they made kind of like this, this material. They made it into a dress, and then they went and applied the Legos to the material so that the Legos would be flexible. And Andrew joked with her and said, you better get your cardio on, Ashley, because the dress weighed 25 pounds.
Oh my goodness.
That's more than what she weighs.
Right. And they used over 40,000 Legos.
Wow.
To make it.
Now, I want to know about her hair. Her hair was fantastic.
I think she did the Ray bun. No, she didn't do the Ray bun.
No, she had her hair like in braids that looked like Leku.
Yes, it was beautiful. So not only was it in these braids like the Leku, there was actually threads. I guess, I don't know if it was fake hair or thread, mm-hmm. but there was blue all through her braids.
Yeah.
And so when she walked out, because I had a really good seat. This was such a fabulous design because it was like a high couture dress. It was fashionably slit because it would have had to be slit or she couldn't walk. And she had these beautiful orange pumps, for Ahsoka. And she walked out and it was beautiful and she could move in it. And I saw her really close up. It fit her figure perfectly because, you know, she kind of has it was kind of square at the top. There's no way they could have made that like a plunging neckline or anything, but she kept that on the entire night. I thought she was going to go do a wardrobe change. No, she wore that dress the entire night. And Wow. Even afterwards, she was taking pictures with people. And so one of the things as press is I can't announce the winner yet. You can find it. Of course, it's very obvious if you go online, but they want to wait until the Con HQ show airs because you'll get a lot of behind the scenes of her getting dressed, all the models. So I think that is going to air this Thursday. Mm-hmm. And then I'll be doing a full write-up of the show for the press outlet I was working for.
I just want to know how awesome. She's going to sit down.
She did. I don't think she sat down. No. I know she walked up and down the stage, but I don't know what she did backstage. She must have leaned.
Do the Anthony Daniels lean?
It was very flexible because the material they designed, they did it so, like, she didn't come out walking like a stick figure. She moved naturally. She talked. She turned because the back of the dress, it was amazing. This because it was all black and the only color on the dress was Ahsoka's face on the side, front side. And then it wrapped all the way around under her arm and down her back and across her waist. And it was just beautifully done.
Good.
And also this year, again, they expanded. I think the first year, last year, Ashley's husband was out. Yeah, David is always out talking to the fans before the show. And they noticed a bunch of people came in cosplay. And so they decided while they were tabulating the votes, how about do a little fashion show for for the fans? And they did a little bit of it last year. And then when they decided announced it was going to be done again this year, the tremendous amount of cosplay it took. They were trying to rush at the end because there were so many people. And there was an amazing girl who did a Jenner. So it was very detailed.
Wow.
So they did that while they were tabulating votes, lots of cute little rays of all. There was a family where, the mom and the daughter, they were all dressed like rebel flight suits, but the mother and daughter had corsets.
Wow.
The flight suit was like a medieval times kind of corset. So that was very creative. And so they just did all of that. And then they came and announced there are actually going to be three winners this year. So if you haven't, if you want to see a look and have a chance to help pick a voter, you can download that app. And when the last show airs this Thursday, you can, I guess there's going to be a phone number or a digital way for you to cast your vote. For the first time this year, there's going to be three winners.
Okay.
There's usually a judge winner, a judge pick, and an audience pick. But there were just some tremendous designs. This one woman used recycled fabric for her outfit, and she made a female WALL-E outfit.
Oh,
nice.
And she used actually recycled tires to make, like, she sewed them into this black skirt. It was,
oh my goodness,
it's really fascinating. Yeah,
that's so amazing. I know we're watching like video footage of Ashley in this dress. Yes. It's like so amazing.
It just looks so heavy.
Yeah, it was, I mean, and I think, I don't know, they must have leaned her against something backstage. I'm looking forward to watching the show because I'm sure they're going to show what they did with her backstage. I don't know if they just like laid her down on something or if, and I don't think she lost a brick. Like, I don't think, and honestly, I was looking as she walked by and I'm like, I don't even see a zipper. Did they sew her in that thing? I don't know how she got in that.
They got hundreds of little kids and just threw Legos at them and said, okay, build her a dress and these kids can do it.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah. Like he said, they used over 40,000 pieces.
Jeez.
What kind of material is this glued onto?
They mentioned it in the video. I'm hoping maybe they'll mention it on the show, but it was some fabric. It was a type of fabric that they knew the Legos could attach to easily. They picked it because of its consistency, it would hold the Legos. I think they either glued them or sewed them. I think they might have sewed them.
Wow.
Because basically they had to create the material was strong enough. So basically they put they used black Lego as a base on the dress, mm-hmm. on the material, and then they built the on top of the dress.
Wow, geez.
That is phenomenal. Yeah. Well, we are so glad that you were able to make it this year to San Diego and go to Comic-Con because these conventions in July, we just can't make. So we're so thankful that you were there. You were able to tweet for us and Facebook and do everything that you did.
You're welcome.
Now, if anyone has any questions that we didn't get to, how can people reach you on social media?
They can reach me on Twitter at Yogi Kai.
Yogi Kai, yay.
Is that like Yogi Bear? Y-O-G-I?
Yes, it's Y-O-G-I-K-A-I. No, Yogi Bear, you're crazy. It's actually nice. Spelled the same way, but put Kai at the end, not Bear.
There you go.
That's not a reference to Yogi Bear? Oh.
No, it's because a person that does yoga is called a yogi.
Yeah.
I've never seen Yogi Bear do that. I think you're making this up as you go along, Kai.
All right.
Well, I'm sure you had a very, very long week. So you go and get some rest and rest up for next year's Comic-Con because we can't make it to that one either.
Oh, that sucks.
That'll wrap up episode 130 of Skywalking Through Neverland. But we want to remind everyone before we go to please send in some more Skywalker stories, some Margaret Carey questions for our upcoming Ask Tink segments, some Skywalker moments, some super secret silly Skywalker talents. Whatever you got, we want to make sure that you are part of the show. Now, one thing about these Skywalker stories, we're looking for a fun story that gets you really excited. Like, hey, I met this person at a convention and we had this to discuss, or I want to share this one moment where I met some other fans that we all got to talking about Star Wars. Something that gets you really excited to talk about. A story you can tell within 5 or 6 minutes.
Yeah, we want those.
Yeah, because we want to make sure that everyone is heard about their fandom, because there's just so many fun stories that we want to make sure everyone is a part of.
And please email us those synopsis of those stories to share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
Now, once again, we want to thank Kevin Raider Nerd Reitzel for coming on, as well as Kai Charles and Dave Parfit for helping to set up some great things for the future.
Before we go, we want to remind everyone to head to retrozap.com, where you can find some awesome shows like Brews and Blasters,
The Deucecast Movie Show,
Techno Retro Dads,
and Talking Apes TV.
And now to get in touch with us during the week, we are at Skywalking Pod on most major social media outlets, including Twitter, Instagram, Periscope, and Snapchat. And we also have our Facebook group where you can be a part of our Skywalker family and get to know other people who listen to the show. Now, it is a closed group on Facebook, so you can search for it by searching Skywalking Through Neverland group or Facebook group, and you should be able to find it and request to join. And once you request to join, please just send us a message to our Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook page and just say, hey, I want to join. I'm not a spammer, you know, that kind of thing.
We get a lot of that.
We do. We want to curate our group and make sure that it's safe and fun and upbeat and positive for everyone there. And it's a great discussion forum. We love it that people pose questions and everyone helps each other answer things. And it's a great place.
A lot of great discussions and a lot of stuff we can get for future episodes, because people have a lot of great conversations. Like, ooh, that's something worthy of making into a segment.
Yeah, and also if we have something that we need an opinion on, we'll post a question in there for our next episode, and any comments that you guys post, we generally will use on our show. And of course, we'll give you credit and say your name. So
once again, we want to make sure that our Skywalker family is a part of each and every episode.
That's right. All right, Skywalkers, well, you can find us on iTunes and many of your other podcatchers, and we love reviews there, by the way. Hint, hint, hint. And we want to thank you all for tuning in. You are our Skywalkers, and we will always remember
Neverland on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
Now, Kevin, before we wrap up here, I want to ask you, though, you said
And Skywalking Through Neverland.
Neverland on Alderaan. Okay,
Just kept on going on and on.
Okay.
There,
well,
I was like, did I miss my cue? I'm sorry.
Oh,
I was like,
no, I don't know. That's okay. It's all good.
Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on... Take two. We needed something for our blooper reel.
Yes.
Okay. Digging the Space Ranger shirt.
So... You know what? We had to post. I don't know. Bleh.
Do you guys know the movie phone guy? For some reason, I always have his voice in my head when I read something like that.
Really?
And now, playing at Chestnut Hill Cinema, it's Guardians of the Galaxy. Guardians of the Galaxy will start at 7 p.m.
What's the movie phone guy? Yes, I know.
Back in the 80s and 90s, we couldn't look up on the internet. Press one. We couldn't look up on the internet because there wasn't any that was easily accessible. Mm-hmm. So you had to call up 1-800-MOVIE-PHONE, and they would tell you, and you put in your zip code, and they would run down a list of theaters, and you press one for Chestnut Hill.
Oh.
And then they would read off the movies and the times.
I would just always call my local theater, and they would do that.
Well, they would never know. Well, they would say, I think it starts at 7:30. I'm not sure.
No, they did it. They would have a pre-recorded system.
Right, but then it came to a point where you couldn't get access to their phones.
Oh.
So you had to call them, the movie phone guy.
Maybe I just always had people who would look it up for me, because I never did that.
The silence your phone guy. No, this is way before that. This is the 1990s.
Oh, you had to listen to the whole thing.
The movie
yeah.
phone. Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back, rated PG. That's how he would talk,
yeah,
too.
I would look at the newspaper. I'm with Mrs.
What's
Rep.
A newspaper?
W. I know. My parents always got it, so I would always look that up.
Yeah. So whenever I'm doing more of the announcer voice, that's the voice I have in my head.
So you're Ted Knight.
No, Ted Knight talks like this. Meanwhile, at the Justice League. I was a movie phone.
Nice.
See? Movie phones, it was big.
I do.
It was like our internet.
Honestly, I do remember like the logo. And I know that it was around. I just don't remember using it.
Yeah.
That's
but,
all.
But first, you have to hear like a preview of a movie that was like 5 minutes long. So before you got to the movie times, you forgot what movie you were looking up.
Right. Right. All right.
Press one.
Okay. So shout outs.
Yes, I'm going to do one more take of this.
No.
And now back to Kevin Raider Nerd Reitzel, Mark Hamill at Star Wars Celebration Europe.
Oh, Clone War Nerd. And I can't even do it. I can't even pretend to do it.
Yeah, I got to practice that one.
That's a good, that's hard to do. Okay.
All right. Shout outs.
I say this?
Sure.
First and foremost.
I'm so glad we're doing a blooper reel.
I know. Okay. Let's take a break from our chat with Kai Charles to hear a sneak peek for next week's episode. Let's take a break from our chat with Kai. All right. Before we go, we want to remind everyone to head to retrozap.com where we are. Bleh. Is that episode going out soon?
No.
Okay. All right, we're done.
All right, bye.
Meh.